October 7th, 2019, 9 a.m. meeting of Alamance County Board of Commissioners. Welcome to you all. Chair Amy Scott Gailey, and we have Commissioner Sutton, Vice Chair Boswell, Commissioner Lashley, and Commissioner Carter here today. And so it's good to see everybody. Commissioner Lashley, do you have an invocation?
I sure do. Let us pray. Gracious Heavenly Father, we pause at this time to honor you. We honor you because you are worthy of honor. We love you because you are worthy of love. We ask for your guidance in the way we live our lives, the way we conduct this meeting, and we just ask you to bless this day in this country. These things we pray in your holy name. Amen.
Amen. You stand and join us in the pledge, please.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Great, so this is a morning meeting. I ask everybody to remember to silence your or turn off your phones, please. And also keep a watch on the time. If you're parked in a parking space that's monitored by the City of Graham, they'll be writing tickets in about a couple hours from now. So you want to watch out for that. And now is the time in our agenda for public speakers who wish to be heard on the items that are on the agenda. There's a second public comment period at the end of the meeting for items that are not on the agenda. And it looks like, Dr. Ulickney, are you, do you want to be heard on an agenda item?
I can.
Right? Yeah, and Donna, I was going through the list.
Yes, okay, sorry.
And I know Laura has signed up for that, Laura Johnson. And then we have somebody on the high desk. So, okay, well, let's just start with Ms. Johnson. Laura Johnson, if you want to go ahead and come up. And while she's coming up, I'll just ask everybody to remember that you can review the rules for public comment period online, that you're limited, each speaker is limited to 3 minutes. And just ask that you review that when you have the opportunity if you plan to come comment. So, good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Can you hear me? Okay. So my name is Laura Johnson. I live in Snow Camp, as you know. I'm here today to express my personal disappointment and frustration with how our county is handling the quarry permit situation. I'm not really interested in hearing from the planning department if the applicants followed the process. I want to hear how they can say that the applicants followed the rules. How is it acceptable that a different map was submitted to the state than to our county? Especially given that the county version leaves off key features like streams and protected structures. Those streams are defined in North Carolina Administrative Code. Our HIDO has no alternative versions. Therefore, we should follow the code and the applicants should follow the code. So why is it permissible to submit a map that excludes code-defined streams and not follow county requirements for setbacks and buffers of those code-defined streams? Why are they allowed to leave off protected structures on neighboring properties which have been there long before the permit application? Does this mean that citizens of Alamance County are allowed to tell the county a version of the truth constructed to fit our personal advantage? Can I disclose only a portion of my property to Alamance County so that I pay fewer taxes here, keep more of my money because it suits my personal economic advantage? Is that the message that we want to send? That Alamance County's rules are made to be bent or broken? What I'd also like to understand is why our county attorney has taken such an interest on the side of this company. Chad Three is or was an employee of a company that knowingly broke our state and federal laws. C. Wayne McDonald has a documented history of lying to a North Carolina community and municipal government for business gain. So how are we then to believe that the differences in the state and county applications are inconsequential? Why are the interests of these two individuals of more importance than thousands in a community in Alamance County who our local government, including our county attorney, is elected or paid to serve? How is Snow Camp supposed to believe that Mr. Three and Mr. McDonald will run a responsible, safe business next to a jet fuel pipeline that runs next to our elementary school when even their application did not follow the rules? These are the questions that taxpayer citizens like me want to know. The residents of Snow Camp have been coming here for a year now, and the time for vacillating is really long past. The site map and the county permit application did not meet the county requirements, and so the permit should not have been issued. It's there in black and white, in the applicant packet, in the state application, and in the HIDO, unless that HIDO is a rule that was made to be broken. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Johnson. All right, Dr. Ulickley.
Thank you. A couple copies of this, hopefully. Okay, good morning. My name is Gary Ulickley, and I reside in Snow Camp, North Carolina. As you know, the citizens of Snow Camp are vehemently opposed to the proposed mine being built in the community, and we are bewildered by what appears to be a bias towards the company who has proposed this project. In the agenda that was sent out publicly, there's an item where our assistant county attorney will conduct a review of the permit issued to Alamance Aggregates for the project. I want to point out and remind you that the county issued an intent to construct permit for this project to C. Wayne McDonald, who represents Snow Camp Property Investments, LLC. We are concerned that our own county cannot accurately identify the actual permit holder in a public document, potentially opening the door for Alamance Aggregates to piggyback on this permit for future projects. As we have pointed out, Alamance Aggregates LLC was not even created until after the permit to Snow Camp Property Investments was approved. To no one's surprise, the review by county officials found no violations of the county HIDO in the intent to construct permitting process, but gives little explanation why. For example, referencing an ordinance dispute in Watauga County, a November 2018 article written by Tom Terrell, who also happens to be the attorney for the applicant, entitled Words Matter, states that the court reminds us that clear and unambiguous ordinances are applied as written and are not subjected to judicial construction. This means that words of an ordinance are not subjective or interpretive, they are taken literally. With that in mind, if we look at the words as written in our current HIDO, under Article 2, Item F, stream buffers, all industries regulated by this ordinance shall be required to maintain a minimum stream setback from any perennial or intermittent stream. As you know, the site plan submitted to the county are drastically different than the one submitted to the state, and the county site plan fails to show all perennial and intermittent streams. But the memo infers that the Alamance County has its own definition of these streams. There is no definition of streams in the HIDO, and Ms. Cattle's memo does not provide or refer to any other definition. Again, the language in the HIDO should stand alone or reference an alternative definition. I provided you with several copies of the Alamance Quarry Preliminary Stream and Wetland Map dated 7/25/18. The map was prepared by an environmental group hired by the applicant and showed several streams, perennial and intermittent, running directly through the mining site. Why weren't these streams included on the county site plan? We also were appalled that the last sentence of Ms. Cottle's memo says, and I quote, the quarry's legal representative has stated that should citizens have any questions, they can contact them for clarity about the project. I want to remind the commissioners, this is the same man who was threatened to sue a productive member of our planning committee and bullied him into recusing himself from any discussion of this project and has not responded to one email that I've sent him. We cannot believe the county's referring its citizens to Mr. Terrell as an unbiased source for clarity concerning this project when they won't even speak to the attorney hired by the affected citizens. Finally, we are surprised that the date of the public hearing on this issue has been moved to a morning meeting instead of the original evening meeting. Our question is, how do commissioners expect to get a representative feedback from citizens affected by this project when the meeting is scheduled when the majority of those citizens are at work? Thank you.
Thank you.
All right, Donna Poe.
Welcome, Donna.
Hello, good morning, y'all. Is this working okay? Can you hear me okay? Okay, all right. Yes, I'm Donna Poe, once again from Snow Camp. And I'll get right to the point. As you know this sad story all too well by now, we've asked you for how many months to take the very clearly detailed violations in our attorney's 7-1 letter seriously. Ask for a conversation, ask for the invalid permit issued to Snow Camp Property Investments, not Alamance Aggregates, be revoked. We asked for an outside counsel at the September 2nd meeting to review same, as it has been obvious from even before the quarry threat, similar pushback relating to the MVP pipeline resolution with numerous citizen complaints that the county attorney is not representative for the citizens of Alamance County. Instead of an outside counsel, more pushback, it was suggested by the county manager at the same 9-2 meeting to have the current planning department director publicly address at the following September 16th meeting the permit process to include the points of our attorney's letter. Said review was instead delayed and produced by a memo to the county manager on September 25th as included in this morning's agenda packet to be formally presented shortly by the assistant county attorney. I prayerfully and respectfully now suggest that during and after the permit review presentation, after all you've heard about this invalid permit that we believe, that you ask many questions, because we are done asking. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Pope. Let's see, I have Eddie McKinnon down to speak. He's remarked that it's on the non-agenda item, and then Mr. Hall. So I'll go down to Chris Jones, who has signed up to speak about the HIDO.
Hi there. I just want to thank the board for providing this forum. Appreciate it. I'm Chris Jones. I represent Carolina Solar Energy. And we've kind of been observing this process of creating the new HIDO. And I just wanted to thank the county really for putting in the time and effort that it really takes to not only protect the community, but provide some room for sustainable growth and industry. And we just really think you guys have done a good job with both the planning board and the board of commissioners here. So anyway, just wanted to publicly acknowledge that. So thank you so much.
Thank you. Okay, do we have any commissioner responses?
Yeah, I'd like to ask, first of all, is there a process that allows the group represents their position or them or their, can they not go to Raleigh and sit with people? Have you done that? Is that feasible to
sit with the mining commission folks?
Well, whoever's got to approve whatever's been submitted.
Well, I think they've been in contact with the mining.
Well, I realize that some letters and Mickey Mouse stuff, but I mean, you know, at a point you just, even if you're wrong, you take the bull by the horn, you do something about it. I mean, is there not a process where they can go down and sit with these people in Raleigh?
Well, I'm sure they would speak to them if they are interested to do that.
Well, I think the state also held a public hearing at Sylvan Elementary School. And
that's sort of the easy way out for them.
I think what the commissioners talk about is they sit down with a group of mining commissioners.
Because they come down and make it look good, and well, we hear you, we're listening to you, and then they get in their car and go back to Raleigh, and it's as if nothing ever happened. Does anybody ever contact them about
yes,
them?
We're in constant contact with the people.
Well, what do they say about coming down there, or have you asked, can you come down?
Yeah, we've had numerous discussions with them, and that process is still ongoing in terms of the state permit.
All right. Because I just feel like we're in an impotent situation where, you know, No. Y'all come here, they're there, our attorney looks at it one way, y'all's attorney looks at it maybe another way, and it just feels like, you know, we're swatting it in air rather than a fly on the wall that you can really let have it. I've never felt more helpless in my life as far as this process that this is. And surely there's a better way to do it. I mean, at a point, you do something. Right or wrong, escorted out of the office, right. You do something.
Yeah.
And now I'm not knocking you.
No. I will say the mining commission, who ultimately you can appeal this to, is not meeting because they haven't been appointed yet by the state.
Okay.
So we have no recourse to go to the people at the state who actually can look at our appeal of some of the rules and regulations because of bureaucratic inaction. So. Mm-hmm. As a libertarian, that is our government at work.
And that's the truth.
Can I speak to Judy Wiener weekly?
I'm sorry?
Judy Wiener is the assistant mining specialist overseeing this application. I speak to her weekly, and I've sat down with her several times.
So you have been now?
Absolutely. But our issues are at the county level. So the county and the state are completely separate.
Well, if they don't approve it, they don't approve it.
because we are a state.
That very rarely happens.
And does anybody else have any comments about first? I'll just I'd like to address Satchi Lickney's saying that it's unfortunate that we're doing the public hearing on the Hydo. It's going to line up for November the 4th. He brought that up, and that is a good comment, observation, and that was actually discussed in the preparation of this agenda, that that's the way that that was going to happen. Discussed not in a matter that, well, that's great, but that's an unfortunate drawback. The thing is that the moratorium on the Hydo expires on December the 1st. And so we're kind of looked at that and then backed up the process. And then we had this meeting today to sort of introduce the new Hydo, which we're doing that in two parts. We're going to talk about part of the new industry development ordinance today. Then we left a scheduled next meeting to finish that up because there are the revisions are extensive. And we want to be sure that we don't run short shrift or skip over anything that's important. And so we're going to do that, the second part of it, on October 21st. And then we scheduled the public hearing for November the 4th to leave the November 18th meeting as an opportunity to vote again, because if ordinance is not voted on unanimously at the first time that it is presented to the Board of Commissioners, then there has to be a second vote. And so there were a lot of things taken into consideration in doing that.
And can people submit written comments then? Is that?
I'm sure you can submit written comments. But if you cannot be here on November the 4th, and I mean, there will also be the opportunity. That's the public hearing that is required in order to adopt an ordinance. You can submit written comments. And also, I mean, there's the public comment opportunity on October 21st as well.
Okay.
So. And there's email, there's a lot that's just the public hearing is required part of the process to adopt an ordinance. So, but thank you for raising that point because it gave me an opportunity to address it, because it's important to me and others that the people know that we would like to have had the public hearing at a night meeting. That would have been better, but because of the timing of how the moratorium expires, that's just the way it worked out. Does anybody else have anything to say before we move on?
Well, we've heard innumerable comments about the difference in the map that was presented to our planning department and the map that was presented to the state. You can't, unfortunately, recall what the explanation was for there being a difference on that clock. Can you address that?
The state map that they're referring to, the state has water quality control. Control. Our Hydo sets spacing and setback strips. We don't control
the process.
The process. The state has that under their jurisdiction.
I have a number of questions on those more content related things. Perhaps when we get into Ben's presentation and the agenda item, we'll have the opportunity to ask questions.
I have one more. You've probably addressed this in the past, but. Explain to me the ramifications, pro or con, of if this board voted after further consideration and further review, the taking of more information, or information that never was told to us, or it appears. Y'all say nobody. I don't believe it. But that we sit back and say we want to reject whatever permit application or whatever, and we just sit back. I mean, we're just acting like we don't know how to handle things. At least in my,
we're acting like we don't have any power.
Yeah, I mean, it's our county.
Once the permit's issued, and they relied on it, they spend money to advance it. It's the concept of vesting. And the case law in North Carolina says once they have a vested right or interest in it, the commission doesn't have the authority to revoke a permit that has been issued. And our ordinance, like it or not, they followed the rules. And the permit was issued. And they hired surveyors and they took steps to advance their application with the state to get their mining permit. So they've spent quite a bit of money up to this point. So I think the board lacks authority to revoke the permit at this point. It's just the nature of state law.
So what would be the liability, Clyde? Do we have any idea, dollar-wise?
Well, July 11th of this year, I think I told the board, you may recall, that they passed a new law that said that if a board, such as this board, exceeds its authority, and a party who is injured by that brings a lawsuit, then the court must order, shall order, the other side's attorney's fees be paid. And that could be significant. The court determines that you've exceeded your authority. My legal opinion is that you would if you revoke a permit that was issued in accordance with the rules. And I understand people don't like the rules. We're going to talk about changes today, ordinance today. But that's just the position we find ourselves in.
Are we not bonded in a situation like that to pay back? Or
I wouldn't think so. If you break the law, you bond, they don't pay anything on it.
Well, I understand that, but I just don't believe it broke the law. you know, it just appears that we're letting money be principal here, and in a lot of areas as well.
Going back to the issue of the public hearing on November the 4th, I was thinking about that. And Mr. Haygood, is there a reason we couldn't have the November 4th meeting at night? Instead, could we reschedule that to a night meeting if that was what the commissioners wanted to do? Would that
sure
be okay with you, Mr. Sutton?
I need to see if I got a class in Greensboro.
Okay, maybe we'll consider.
If you don't mind.
We'll consider that maybe, and we can just do that by sending out an email to the board and letting the public know, right?
I think the board has to actually take action to do that, but would be able to do that at the October 21st meeting. That would be enough time. So if you wanted to check your schedules and see if November 4th evening would work, you could take a look, let us know. We'll make sure everybody on the board knows that. And then on October 21st, you could consider that as an item to move the meeting to nighttime on November 4th.
Okay. That would be nice. Okay, great. Okay. Then let's move forward with the rest of our agenda. And if everybody's had the opportunity to review the agenda, if we could have a motion to approve it. Thank you. I have a motion and a second to approve the agenda. All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Then we have a few items on the consent agenda. If people have had the opportunity to review those things, we can have a motion to approve the consent agenda. I have a motion and a second to approve the consent agenda. There's no discussion. All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Thank you. Okay, next we have a library committee appointment. Susanna Goldman is here to talk to us about that. I think we had quite a few people apply to be on the library committee.
Good morning, Commissioners.
Good morning.
Yes, we had a vacancy on our library committee. It's been about a year now since the vacancy happened, but it was while I was an interim director. So we posted the position vacancy on our website, on social media, in I think it was February or March of this year, looking for interested parties to join the committee, and we received 10 applications. At that time, we stopped accepting applications at the end of May and started looking through them all around that time. Our process is basically, you know, I review them and narrow it down to a pool based on some of their interests. Not their interests. Are they library patrons? I talk to them a little bit. And then I present a smaller number than 10 to our board and our board chair, and then we discuss it. And after our last committee meeting, we are recommending Paula Hendricks as the committee a recommendation for you to appoint her to our committee.
Who went off?
It was a year ago, so I can't tell you for sure the name of the person. I can look it up and let you know.
Motion to approve.
Second.
We have a motion and a second to approve appointing Paula Hendricks to the Library Committee. Is there any discussion? If not, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Thank you. All right, Tammy Wall is here to give us a report on workforce development. Good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Thank you for having us. I believe that you have received a copy of our annual report, and I just wanted to highlight a couple of the items in that report. If you are on, well, you don't have the same thing I have, but early on is our performance report, and as you know, the Federal Department of Labor sets performance measures for us to meet, and there are 23 workforce boards in North Carolina, and I wanted to highlight the fact that Regional Partnership Workforce Development Board exceeded all performance measures for that program year, the only workforce board to do so. So I know that's a little tooting your own horn, but you got to do it when you can.
Somebody else is going to do it for us.
This is the tooting time.
So another thing I wanted to point out was on page 11, it shows the amounts expended in Alamance County, our adult program. We used $213,823 to train adult job seekers in our county to either receive educational training or on-the-job training with Alamance County employers. We also worked with dislocated worker population and spent $144,860 on that population. We did work with our WIOA youth program. I know the youth is a term we tend to think of children, but these are individuals who are age 16 up to 24. And we spent $219,739 on those, also for training at community colleges and or work-based learning in the community. Some things that are not in the report, but I feel worth mentioning, are the Eastern Triad Workforce Initiative that was implemented in program year 2018. So we just closed out that year recently. We spent in Alamance County $19,421.78 with five local Alamance County employers, where 119 employees received training in either leadership, SolidWorks, first aid, CPR, bloodborne pathogen, and electrical panel management, where new equipment was purchased at one of our larger manufacturing facilities from Italy, and we had someone from Italy come out and train those staff to utilize that equipment. Also, we had 17 job seekers and three employers that we placed with employers in Alamance County and spent $111,296.30 on-the-job training. These 89% of those employees are remaining employed with those same employers. I know two that received went to other employers where they received pay increases, and so that was our Eastern Triad Workforce Initiative funds. We also had a Finish Line grant that was an initiative from Governor Cooper, and Alamance County is one of the top three counties in North Carolina who has exceeded the established goals for Finish Line Grant. Finish Line Grant helps community college students who are more than 50% of the way through training to receive financial assistance if they experience a crisis that may force them to quit school. So Alamance County has 171 awards were submitted, 90 students received $93,879.58 in emergency funds to enable them to remain in school. Of those students who were in their final semester, all of them completed training and are now employed.
Good. Good report.
I'm going to give you, this is the county numbers just for the center here. I'm Lisa Arnett, and I'm the center manager here. And it's an honor to be the manager here in Alamance County. I think we're the best county in the state. We work together. We work with multiple agents. The reason we were successful with Finish Line Grant is because of our close ties with Alamance Community College, VR, the Chamber of Commerce. We all partner together here. I think, believe it or not, Alamance County is very unique in that. I can tell you, as a state employee, talking to my peers across the state, we are very unique that we do work together, but we work together for the good of our citizens and our businesses. I was talking to some people before. They said, well, unemployment rate's so low. Are y'all got anybody in the center? We have some people in the center. But I told them this year was unique for us that we actually provided probably the largest, if you'll check, the largest number of services to employers that we ever have done, because the employers are really needing help finding the labor that they need. So they turn to us, and we really work very hard. We have them at the center and try to get them, you know, the people to come in and talk to them. So we've worked really hard doing OJTs, doing on-site recruitments for them so they can get the labor they need to be successful here. Okay. Thank you.
Before you go, do we know of any numbers of the rate of temporary workers we have in this county in relation to other counties or a region or?
No, sir, that's not really tracked per se. I could check with the state and see if there's numbers on that if you'd like. But there can, they, well, once you're employed, let's say with a temporary service, you're considered employed by the state. And that's considered an entity, and it's actually under, if you looked on labor market information, it's under professional and technical services. Because they're actually tied to an employer, the state considers them employed. They don't really consider them employed temporarily, even though it could be a temporary assignment, or it could be a temp to hire assignment, or, you know, it could be a day assignment even. But the minute they're employed and pay those taxes to the state, they're considered employed.
Is that a trend in our area for a lot of companies to hire through personnel as?
I think it was a trend, to be honest, because labor is so tight. I've known several major employers that have come into our center this past year and have switched some of their temporary workers over to permanent workers because they know they need to keep that labor pool.
That's good.
So it's just like with everything else in the economy, supply and demand, yes, sir.
Could you check on it, though?
I'll call Raleigh in our labor market division and see if that's something they track. I'll be happy to do that. I'll be happy to follow up.
Thank you. Any other questions?
I've heard a number of comments that the low unemployment rate we have right now is essentially a full employment rate.
Economists consider 5% unemployment full unemployment historically. I think with the economy and the way it's been, that's not really considered true anymore, really. I think that bar kind of moves. Okay. I'm not an economist, so.
It sounds like to me Trump is doing a good job.
I'm covered by the Hatch Act.
No comment.
Thank you for your time, sir.
Thank you very much for coming today. All right, Ben Pierce, our assistant county attorney, is going to talk to us about the permit that was granted to Alamance Aggregates to
their intent to construct permit. Bruce, if you could get I think it's the final app plan for that map, please. I am here, I think the concern was that since Tanya has so much else on the agenda, you might get tired of hearing her voice, so I'm here in the role as Tanya today. The first, we'll get into some things on that, but apparently the letter that was sent from Breedle's lawyer had various points, and I've been asked to address those points. The first is the expiration of the permit. Our ordinance says that you have to have this intent to construct permit before you commence construction activities. The ordinance defines construction activities as studies, investigations, operations, improvements, or other activities undertaken at the site of the proposed regulated industry pertaining to the construction, placement, erection, establishment of the same, including but not limited to, and it goes on to list various other things that I won't read you. So what's clear is the Alamance Aggregates people have engaged in construction activity and have been engaging in construction activity as a part of their dialogue with the state and getting their mining permit. We would define that under our ordinance as construction activity, and so it's would keep it continually invested. They are actively working out there, and we don't believe when you read the unfortunately it's somewhat ambiguous about the expiration, but I think when you look at the sentence as a whole, you can't say that the permit has expired due to inactivity, because they are actively engaged in trying to begin construction. Since the permit is vested, we think that that is not grounds for the county to revoke the permit. Moving on to the technical thing, Bruce, if you could zoom in to there in kind of the upper item number two, in kind of the right side of the map, middle of the page. I don't know if you can see that or if it's just... Okay. This is the stream buffers and setbacks. Our ordinance requires that the plat show a 100-foot setback from the stream. And as you can see, that is present on the map. There's a 50-foot buffer, which is the DEQ rules, and a 100-foot setback, which means that no buildings can be constructed in that. And then number three, if you want to zoom back out, Bruce, please. And in the upper left is the house. Now this map, because they're outside of the 2,000 foot circle, it says item number three right there, that is the location that I am informed is called the Sanders house. There is a previous map that I believe shows that the house is 2,077 feet from the center of operations, and as such is outside the 2,000 foot circle, and so wouldn't be required to be shown on this map. You can see there are some other houses, if you look at the other side of the screen, in the circles. Those are some of the houses that the Alamance Aggregates people purchased that are inside the structure, inside the circle, and those are shown. But the houses that are outside wouldn't be required to be on this map. Another comment that their attorney made is about the lighting plan. Is there any way, Bruce, I can get you to pull up a file labeled lighting plan? As you can see, they have provided a lighting plan that shows the location of their permanent lights. Going back, Bruce, if we could go back to the main map there. Down at the bottom, 5A and B are streams and buffers again that are shown on the map. If you want to back out, please, Bruce. In the upper left-hand side of that, what is 5C? Which is the floodplain and marginal area, which is shown on the map as the blue lines. If you back out to 5D, that's going to be kind of right there at the property line. Those show locations of structures involved in operations such as skimmer basins and drainage fields that they have marked on their map. And then, Bruce, if we could go for 5E, go to the landscape map file. Landscape plan, yeah. Their attorney said that the design of parking lot, including proposed lighting stalls, handicap parking stalls, and distance was not shown. As you can see, they submitted a map that shows how they're going to do the parking in their office. They were also said that there was no dimension in loading berths. Since this is not the kind of business that requires loading berths, we didn't require them to put that on the map. You can go back to the main file, Bruce. This one doesn't have a number, but this is the location of proposed gate and signage. If you look on the road, there's a yellow, it's kind of hard to see on this, but there's a yellow line that is their proposed fence and gate. You can see where it crosses the road there. And then I believe you've already, the last comment that they had was that we didn't have the lighting again. And as you have seen earlier, they did submit a map that showed the lighting.
Where's the pipeline at on that? Can you go to that?
Yeah, if you back out, Bruce, the pipeline runs across the top of this property. And see these, the black, or I guess the purple right through there? That is the location, the easement for the pipeline. Where the actual pipeline is in the ground is considered sensitive security information, and you wouldn't put that on a plat like this. But
it would be
it's some easement, somewhere inside that easement. I'm not going to say it's in the middle, but it might be.
Well, they mark them all over Greensboro, Gilbert County, yeah.
Don't typically, they are in
don't
the
dig here.
Right.
Someone told me that.
So,
yeah, actually, you can fly over and see
it. Yeah, you can fly over and see it. I imagine it's probably pretty close.
I've seen it.
But that wouldn't, the exact location is something I don't think that they would make them put on a map like this. So, as you can see, and this is the kind of plat review that would be done by our planning office, which is, especially for a project like this, this is their intent to build. So there's nothing on the ground out there to check by. They just, we make them show these various things, and I'm guessing Libby went down, I wasn't involved in reviewing the plat when she did it, but she went down and checked the boxes to see that they were on the map, and then issued them their intent to construct permit.
Where's the school that was referenced?
The school is
Sylvanus.
It's, yeah. It's well outside this map. This map just shows that property and then what would be around it, that inside that 2,000 foot circle. It's not, the school wouldn't be on the map.
So these stream buffers we keep talking about here, in our original acceptance of that, because I remember way back when they come up with the Hall River protection plan, basically, that stream buffers, we pretty much went with the state on those.
That's my recollection, is that we used the exact rules that the state provided to
right.
us. We said, tell us what the minimum requirements are, and we adopted those.
And we've got a discrepancy from what they're saying as opposed to what's happening. And I don't understand that, I guess, is what I'm saying.
And I don't have a particularly good answer other than to say the maps are prepared for different governmental bodies for different mm-hmm. purposes. And ours would be the streams that show up on our GIS, I'm guessing, is what they went with, versus whatever the state considers a stream. I know the state has very particular rules about what they consider and what they don't. I don't know.
But when we wrote those ordinance back, they sent them to us. They said, this is what you have to go by mm-hmm. from the state. How are we having a discrepancy now as to our rules being less than their rules? Because we did mm-hmm. say, okay, we've got to accept it because the state at that time said, these are the rules and you'll have to abide by them. Mm-hmm. So I don't see where we have a variance either way.
I don't know. I wasn't involved in reviewing the plat. That's all that I have, is to just run through the checklist that their attorney sent and show where these things are, in fact, on the map. If there's any questions, I'll be happy to take a stab at them, but some of these might be better directed to Tanya, who is more involved in the day-to-day plat review than I am.
Do we need Tanya to come in here?
Before you step away, let me just ask one more time. We've got a county map that shows streams on it. There's a map that was submitted to the state that shows streams and water features that were not included on the county map, and that does tend to lead one to think that they're playing, that there was some kind of hiding the ball there, that they put what they had to on the county map to get what they needed, the permit, and then when they go to the state, then they add more stuff. What would be an answer to that?
Well, I don't know. This would have been done before the state map. This is the map that was submitted to us that we reviewed and issued the permit on, or I'm told that we reviewed. I didn't do it. I don't know what map they would have sent to the state, other than to say the state has their rules for what they want to see on plats, and this is what Libby required to be on the map for our purposes.
Tanya, can you take your own stab at answering that question, please?
So the best I can say is the state issues us our GIS layer for hydrology, which is on our external site. They show us what the intermittent and perennial streams are. We don't make that decision.
Yeah, slow down.
Slow planning, folks.
He lost me at intermittent perennial streams.
Okay, so the state determines these streams. We don't. They give us the GIS layer that shows us where these perennial and intermittent streams are so that we have guidance on where they are. They make these determinations regularly. We get the uploads and we use them. So that's where our information comes from. To compare to these maps that we get, we're getting the information straight from the state. Now, everybody knows the state has their own division of water quality, and they're going to ask for a whole lot more information than what we have or that we would go by. That's my guess on why their map is different, because they're asking for a whole lot more detail and probably more than just intermittent and perennial streams on their map. But we're just going by the data that we're given to say, these are intermittent perennial, these are what y'all have to regulate.
How do we know that the person applying for the permit has submitted a map with their permit application, which is accurate and complete?
Well, for us, if we see it on our GIS or don't see it on our GIS, that's what's going to flag us.
So you're going to pull your own map up off the GIS,
the data that they're giving
to
us.
What's submitted.
Right.
Is that right?
Mm-hmm. And we do that all day for everybody that walks in the office. This is specifically called out in our ordinance, so we pull our GIS up and say, yes, this looks like it, or, ooh, they're missing something, kind of thing.
So have you looked at the map that was submitted to the state and compared it to the county GIS and seen that there were things on the state map which were not on the county's GIS website?
So the map that I can see from the state is very hard to read. I can see that there are some things on there, and I mean, they may call out something as small as a puddle. Anything that would even slightly pull water, the Division of Water Quality is going to question and want labeled so they can investigate. But the map that I've got is more than difficult to read, so it's hard to appreciate what they're looking at.
A real stream. Is that what you're saying?
They have different levels of streams than we do. They get to call all kinds of things that we wouldn't even understand how they got there. So we're just using what they give us for that intermittent and perennial. And, you know, intermittent streams just means they're wet some of the time. Perennial usually means they're wet about all year long unless there's drought like we're in now, and everything dries up. So that they make those determinations. They get to decide what they want on their map. And we use the data based on what they send us for our intermittent and perennial determination.
Are they using standards perhaps from the Corps of Engineers, something like that?
Oh, I'm sure they're involved as well. They're that's what they do all day long, so they've got a whole lot more detail than what we're looking for.
Well, back to Commissioner Boswell's point, that if I remember or can articulate that correctly, that his memory is that when the county adopted its stream ordinances and rules, regulations, that it was relying on the state.
Yes.
that was pretty much our discussion. I think Ray Cobb back there was on the board at that time of the planning board.
Yeah, I was.
And now we hear that there may be a discrepancy there, that the reason that things don't show up on the county map is because that is not the way that things work presently. Mr. Albright, can you address that? Has there been some kind of shift to your knowledge or change in the state's definition of streams that the county ordinance is not somehow kept up with?
I know the ordinance was drafted in 2011, and I know the state changes their water quality rules frequently. I don't know specifically what they changed, but I do know that it is a constant, it's a moving target with the Division of Water Quality. And the current administration in Washington is trying to rein that back in because they call everything navigable waters of the United States. As Ms. Cottle just said, it's small as a puddle. So that's the type of entity you're dealing with. And Raleigh has the people that are the experts in hydrologists. We don't. So in the 8 years that this ordinance has passed, they very well have changed that.
From the state to what we have in place.
Is there a place in our current HIDO that defines a stream?
No, I don't believe so. I think that would be common usage. I don't think we define stream.
So there's no reference back to another ordinance, no incorporation by reference of a...
I don't believe so. That would be one of the things that if the board feels needs to be changed in the proposed draft, and that would be, these are the kind of problems that become identified that we need to fix.
Well, and when we had that discussion in 2011, that was part of the overall scenario. We didn't really have a choice as a county. We couldn't set our own stream buffers, you know, because sometimes developers would prefer not to have some of those stricter ordinances, but we had to go by exactly what the state had done. So I would think, though, in moving forward, our ordinance would just stay with what the state would say without having to go back and rechange our verbiage in 2011. Is that not true?
It is, and as you may recall, the Jordan Lake rules were the big hammer that was being dropped on everybody.
Right.
There was a lot of uncertainty in those rules. Still is.
Yeah.
And they're changing.
Should we not then require in our new ordinance that any update to the state requirements be recognized in as a part of the new ordinance going forward?
Well, we could reference the state rules. I'm sure could.
They supersede our rules anyhow, whether we accept them or not. That was the discussion we had.
They take control.
So the difference in the two maps essentially is that we had a map that met our ordinance requirements, and the map that was submitted to the state met the state ordinance requirements.
Let me ask this. If the map that was submitted to the state as part of the state's permitting process, if that had been the map that had been submitted to the county for the county permit, would Alamance Aggregates have been granted the permit, the county permit?
I don't know.
How can we, I'm sorry, how can we not know that after a year?
Yeah. I don't have a copy of the map that we can actually read.
Dr. Ulickney has provided
I think that's
map.
What Dr. Ulickney brought up here this morning. From the state, is that correct, Dr. Ulickney?
Yes. The one you have right there is the Army Corps engineers taking off the GIS. Okay. You can see that.
I think the answer would still be centered on the actual operation and the distance from the stream. No matter what definition it is, it's a state definition, which is more strict, a stricter definition, they still wouldn't be able to build on it. We just said there's a stream there, and we put, let's say, 100-foot buffer from the stream.
That's not a risk.
And if the state later comes along and says, well, we'll give you a permit, but you've got to be 200 feet from the stream,
no operations, state law of control. So I would assume that if you have enough land, you could still put your operation in there. And they seem to have quite a amount of acreage. I think it's 380, 400 acres of land. That's just a guess. I don't know what the state rules were 2 years ago. I don't know what they are now as far as the definition of streams. But that's what is the moving target.
That's a good question.
I would like to hear your thoughts, Mr. Sutton.
I think you've heard enough from me, but that's the best question I've heard asked today.
Well,
discovery is what it is. Yeah. And I don't know if anybody continues the process once they find out there's something there, no matter what the law says. Congress certainly doesn't do it. Doctors, I hope, won't do it. The government here at the local level should. But rhetorical, is that? That was your question. And I'd like to know about that. About any.
I will say that I do, with going back to the issue about whether or not there's been no activity for a year since the permit has been granted, I think it's clear that there has been activity, that the application for the state, and they've done a lot of paperwork, book work, run around. Just because they haven't put a shovel in the ground in a year doesn't mean that they haven't made substantial investment or progress toward getting a permit, and that the year for the grant, you know, the year that they have until they start constructing, I think it's told as long as they're doing other stuff. It's not fair to make, to punish a company because the state is holding them up. So that seems clear to me, but the rest of it is not.
And that issue is attempted to be addressed in the new HIDO, where there's a process to identify the permits and how long they think those are going to be able to take, so that we have some idea at the outset whether a year is a realistic timeline, or if we're looking at 4 years, yeah, or however long. You know, tell us what you need and how long this is going to take, so that we've got some idea at the very beginning of what we're looking at.
Is this a typical timeline for the state to deal with a permit application?
Well,
I mean, I know there's not typical, but
right.
I would think there's quarries that have applied, and how long is that taken, and those type of things.
I don't have a definitive answer to that. My dealings with the state government, they usually take longer than anyone expects to get your decision.
And it's been going on a long time, so.
I've worked with the Department of Motor Vehicles on a couple of things, and I'm still waiting for an answer. But I guess it depends on the department and what staffing they have.
Because, number one, you have citizens that are in limbo right here with what they're dealing with, and you have a company that's in limbo where they're going and what they can do. So,
I think in conversations that I've had with Donna Poe, she's talked about her talking to, it's a Judith Weiner from the state, and that it's taken 4 years for some people to get their state permit in the past. So it can take a really long time. All right, well, if anybody else has anything related to the permit, we should probably move on to starting to talk about the new...
Thank you, Ben.
Thank you, Ben. Heavy Industrial Development Ordinance. As we get started, there were... So the Planning Board created a subcommittee to create a draft heavy industrial development ordinance that they worked on extensively over a period of several months. That, I believe, is in your agenda packet online, the product of that subcommittee. At your desk this morning was a paper copy of a heavy industrial development ordinance. And Mr. Hagan, I believe this is a staff-created version, is that correct?
That's right.
And so some of the county staff, Ms. Cattle and Ben Pierce and others, created this draft ordinance, which differs in some respects from the one that the subcommittee created. So I hope that that is not too confusing, and that as we go forward, that the board will be able to use the differences to highlight or eliminate what work has been done. So that's what that is.
Great. Okay, good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning.
What we have today is the beginnings of the discussions of the heavy industrial development ordinance that, as y'all know, we've been working on for some time through subcommittee. I want to let you know that subcommittee is here.
Ray will be back.
Yeah. Ray is here. Y'all saw him earlier. Lee and, what's your name?
Bill
Potter. Ray messed me up totally.
Not me. You, Bill. I'm surprised.
Bill, Lee, and Ray have been working on this for some time, for months and months. They've been meeting weekly. They've done field trips out to uses that will fall under this ordinance so they can see and feel what that's like as they move through and try to make the best ordinance that we possibly can have at the county. You know, without a complete start over and rewrite, we're just touching up the ordinance that we have to make it do the things that we've notice that need to be done. Public have made comment to us. So those are the things that we tried to address in this ordinance. So what I've got for you is just a real short PowerPoint for y'all today. And hopefully that gets up. So what you see up there is the actual land spacing and setback requirements from the 2011 ordinance to the 2019 ordinance. So you've also got that on your iPad, y'all can probably see the 2019 better. So you see a lot of differences. We won't talk about too much today, but the classes have changed. So we went from 4 classes to 3 classes with the new recommended upgrade from the subcommittee and planning board approved. So what you see is setbacks from the 2011 ordinance started at 75 feet for a class 1. And then for class 2 as well, and then you got 100 feet, and then 2. Okay. And then for the 2019, you've got class 1, which again the classes have changed, but that moved to 125 feet, and then a class 2 at 125 feet, and then you've got a 500 foot setback for the class 3, the new class 3s. So you can see those numbers have changed. That came from a lot of discussion of business, citizen, and where the benefits and where hopefully the middle of the line was, and that's where the subcommittee tried to fall and working this out for the county and for the people of the county, and yet for business of the county, to kind of balance that as best we could. But then when you look at land spacing originally started at 250 and then it doubled as you went down up to 2,000 foot for the class 4. Land spacing with the new ordinance, which that yellow highlight is terrible, is not the same. So the new land spacing for class 4, or I guess class 3, the new class 3. I've got all 3 versions here if y'all have questions on anything, because your staff version there puts you at a 2,000 foot setback for all the upper classes and then 250 for the lower class. So, but the subcommittee's class 3 setback is, or land spacing, is 1,200 feet. So that's a pretty big number jump from the, any of the other classes, and that was done on purpose, that these are the most intrusive uses that we could possibly get, and there's a lot of uses in that class 3. I think I have. So class 2 is at the 150 foot, and then class 1 has no land spacing. They're just going strictly off setbacks for the new ordinance. And you see the old ordinance had setback and land spacing for every category.
Can you explain exactly what land spacing means? Like,
well, it depends on which ordinance you're in. That's slide 2. So in the first ordinance, in the ordinance we currently would go by, land spacing is the spacing from the center of the operation out. So for the quarry purposes, it was 2,000 feet from the center of the operation out in a big circle all the way around the operation.
Drawn from that center.
That's right. I don't know if y'all know, but when you have something that's not a square or a circle or a rectangle, center is probably kind of engineering level math. So the new proposed ordinance pulls that land spacing just to the property line. You measure from the property line. You're not guessing where the middle is of anything. You're straight from the property line out. So by land spacing shrinking, it is and it isn't, because you're not measuring from the center anymore. All that space is taken up. You're measuring literally from that property line out.
So it makes a big difference on how much you would have left over or where that spacing would sit. Theoretically, it probably wouldn't sit that different for the class two than it would originally. Now class three, which is what the quarry would be in now, is still a 1,200 foot setback. So it's 1,200 feet from the property line, not from the center. So you're only talking about 800 foot difference from what the current ordinance shows, but it's coming from a totally different place. So it could push it further out. Yeah.
That significantly increased the amount of real estate in the buffer.
That's right. And so what our current ordinance allows, and that's part of what this covers, is spacing waivers. Y'all probably heard some of that language thrown around, but currently, as the ordinance is 2011 written, spacing waivers are granted by property owners adjacent to, and they sign off this easement ability for them to encroach onto their property. Okay, the 2019 version doesn't look at it that way. It says that property owner needs to say it's okay, you know, we put it on paper, but the actual approval comes from this board. So it's no longer citizens writing it off for use. This board makes that final decision to say that makes sense or no, that's not a good idea. We don't like that. So that's a huge change in what used to be and what is, or could be, I guess, in the new standards. I think that's pretty much it for what I was going to try and cover today. And because we're breaking this into two parts, the rest of the ordinance is a lot of language changing, but not as significant as this.
Can we go ahead and talk about the change in classes today?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Because that's a huge change.
It is.
And also how the land use spacing would be for the different classes.
All right. So I don't have a slide for this because I didn't think we're doing classes, but let's talk through. Y'all have the new ordinance on your iPad, so let me talk you through what the current ordinance shows. Currently, a class one includes only three: fuel bulk storage, ready-mix concrete suppliers, and inert debris landfills. That's it for the class ones.
Let me interrupt you real quick. The staff version would add the alternate energy generating facilities to class one. And that's like solar farms, right? So the staff draft would put solar farms as a class one.
And that really is the only class change for that staff draft, I believe, right, from the current ordinance. So we'll add that to class one for the staff version. Class two, as it currently is soft mining resource extraction, chemical manufacturing. As it stands now, solar farms are in a class two, and automobile salvage and storage facilities. Those are current class two uses. Class three currently is waste facilities, chip mills, and racetracks. And racetracks even have an additional language in the setback and land spacing. So class three racetracks, the acreage is 40 acres instead of 10 acres, what a normal class three would need to be. And then land spacing is still 1,000 feet and 100 foot setback. So the total acreage changes in the current ordinance for racetracks. Class four is hard mining, resource extraction, quarrying, asphalt plants, fossil fuel generating facilities, landfills except inert debris, cement manufacturing, metal recycling, and salvage facilities. So that's how we currently break them down, but since the public doesn't have our ordinance right in front of them like you all do, let me just read out a little bit. Class ones now would be fuel bulk storage, ready-mix concrete suppliers, inert debris, landfills, renewable energy generating facilities.
This is under the subcommittee draft.
Right, this is the planning board approved draft. Automobile salvage and storage facilities, resource extraction, metal recycling, and salvage facilities. All of that is the new class ones. Class two, however, only has two uses: a waste facilities and sawmills. Sawmills are defined a little bit differently now in the new ordinance, kind of pulled out from.
Are they in class one? Sawmills.
Currently,
They were actually
class three.
They fell in with the chip mills originally, okay, and they've been kind of separated out. Because of their, I guess, nuisance, the subcommittee pulled these and separated this stuff out a little more. So your class threes are the big ones. That's the mining and quarrying. The racetracks are a class three still, but a little higher on setbacks and land spacing. Chemical manufacturing, asphalt plants, electricity generating facility, not the same as a renewable energy, which is just a solar energy. And then landfills except inert debris, paper mills. So paper mills and sawmills used to be chip mills, kind of all the same. We've separated that out for the planning board approved. And then cement manufacturing. So it did break down a bit differently with the new ordinance. And that's why you see the land spacing and setback requirements a bit different than what you're used to seeing in the old ordinance, including that your land spacing is measured from property line, not from the center operation. That's a huge consideration when you start drawing. It looks really different. And the impact is, it goes further out depending on what you put that land spacing at. So the 1,200 foot land spacing for that class three, which as you can tell, these are high nuisance uses. They needed a little more attention and they needed a little more buffering from everybody. So that's what that land spacing is for. And that's a lot to say and to take in if anybody has questions. But this has been worked on for months, so it wasn't something that was just kind of thrown out at a meeting. It was multiple meetings and multiple site visits to get there.
Well, it makes sense looking at the new classifications of each individual thing and to actually say that sawmills are less intrusive than a chip mill. So, I mean, somebody's thought about what's going to be
right, and the somebodies are sitting right here if you have any questions for me.
Yeah, they've thought that through, so that's good.
So, well, I don't want to y'all ask questions and I'm going to do it.
Good.
Anybody? So,
I'm kind of trying to figure out this 1,200 feet from the property line. That's
the why?
That's going to make for a pretty big footprint overall, mm-hmm, correct?
Oh, yeah.
If you take up even up, I don't know, take a square parcel,
mm-hmm,
10 acres. 1,200 feet, I'm not sure what the math does, but 1,200 feet all the way around that square parcel is going to be significantly larger.
Yeah, it is.
Right, so the minimum size is 40 acres for these. Obviously, these types of uses are going to be more than that. Even when we look at a racetrack, 1,200 feet, if there's an... He would like for y'all to have these handouts. So the planning board did get, so he was prepared to talk to this evening as well.
Oh, good. Okay.
There we go. So that kind of shows you. So this shows you that class three of the 1,200 foot land spacing and the 500 foot setback.
Do we have any idea what that would do to the overall footprint, though, the space that was required, what I was asking?
Well, of course, it depends on the parcel.
Right, but I mean, if you say 40 acres, if you go 1,200 feet out from a 40-acre boundary, right?
Mm-hmm.
Assume the 40 acres is square. Go 1,200 feet out. On at least three sides of the fronts on a road, I guess. I don't know, maybe you just have to go across the road too.
Yeah, the roads aren't differentiated, yeah. Stop there. So yeah, it's substantial. That seemed to be the feeling from the public and even from some at the planning board. So the feeling to make that class three substantial protection, that's what that came from.
So these class one uses, is it fair to say that it's a lot easier under the planning board's height aversion is substantially easier to locate a class one facility than it is under the 2011
height? It is easier. I mean, your setback has changed from 75 feet to 125 feet, which is a difference, but there is no land spacing requirement. So it pulls it into the property to keep it away from their neighbors substantially more, but it doesn't go over a property line or anything.
And that would include, and then that also, we have solar farms being moved to class one under both the staff draft and the planning board draft. But the planning board draft has the automobile salvage and storage facilities and then metal recycling and salvage facilities in it. Mm-hmm. So it makes it easier to locate those.
Right, the requirements are just a little different than it used to be if they can deal with the setback within the land spacing.
Well, I can see why the, Chris Jones from the solar company came and said, we like it. Good job.
Help.
Good work.
You helped.
And he's been at just about everyone in Cleveland meetings, too, along the way. Because we've had several revisions, and those have been out on the website. And this version is on the planning website as well for anybody to take a look. So that everybody can kind of get a feel for it. We'll get to public hearing. Everybody's had it for, I've had it out since the week of the planning board meeting or the week before the planning board meeting in September, so it'll been out there for a little while.
Well, has anybody calculated, back to my question, anybody calculated the amount of land area that would actually be involved within that 1,200 foot buffer on a 40 acre parcel?
We did talk about that. Yeah, it's been a while, we had calculated the acreage and everything, but it also depends on its shape, too, but we also know that 40 acres probably ain't going to do it for any of these types of uses. 40
right.
acres will be small, especially to meet the setback, the 500-foot setback and then the 1,200-foot spacing. You need more than 40 acres to do it. So then your acreage increases, of course, because your parcel is bigger.
Man, I do think it makes more sense to go from the boundary line, from the property line, than it does from the center of the project.
Well, that makes it easier for anybody trying to look at it, anybody reviewing it, or even the facility trying to come.
Yeah, that's right.
I just, I guess it's a concern getting to that number. What's the impact on other industry trying to come into the county if we make this land area requirement so large that trying to find a spot where you've got the acreage with the buffer to protect it.
And I can go back
and scale. Don't pull the baby out of the bathwater, so to speak.
That one, and see. You see the big reddish colored circle? That's their 2,000 foot land spacing from the center. Some of it stays on the property, and some of it's pretty substantial where it goes off the property.
Mm-hmm.
And as you tell, that's not a square, so center is.
And most parcels are not square in North Carolina.
If we were looking at this project, we'd be going 1,200 feet out all the way around that boundary.
Yes.
Yes. Idea being the protection that we've heard at public meetings.
From any of the operation, that basically is what you're doing.
Just
not going around that property line.
Mm-hmm. And of course, you've got landscaping requirements within that setback too, to at least maybe protect from noise or any, I don't know, from like luck or any dust or whatever that might be coming from.
I'd like to say that I really appreciate taking away the spacing waivers and changing that. As it is under the 2011 ordinance, that essentially people could sign away the ordinance. They were a neighbor and it was okay with them, then they could just sign it away. Whereas if you're just one parcel over,
you get hurt by it.
You can still get possibly damaged by the class four use in particular.
Right, the nuisance may not stop it right where that line is, so that would definitely be something you wouldn't want citizens unknowingly passing off and signing off and not realizing the nuisance that could be there.
Yeah.
That's true. That's a good point. The unknowing, or like if you have an unscrupulous person who comes in and represents one thing to the neighboring property owner, then they sign it away and it turns out that they were not being forthcoming with all the facts, then this would be a way to protect that.
And we don't assume anybody, we assume that people unknowingly do a lot of things, because I don't know if y'all know that land use and nuisances and things are hard to predict sometimes if you don't have already experienced or know a little bit about it. So we want to take that burden off the citizen and let it be discussed by multiple people and hopefully bring some into the meeting of people that know exactly what they're doing, and maybe the applicant will come too. We'll see.
I ask you a question. I don't want you to go backwards too far, but I know every county in South Carolina is zoned, right? County's up, county-wide zoned.
Mm-hmm.
All right. In your opinion, the placement is one thing, but the actual entity itself is another. Do you think our rules are would be comparable, more lenient, or tighter to what you saw there?
We'll say it's going to be more lenient. Because we don't have zoning, we don't have some of the controls that they would have had. And of course, state law is different, North Carolina, South Carolina, but we would definitely be a little more lenient on what we don't require.
What I don't understand, I understand zoning versus placement in relation to zoning.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, but the actual entity itself, the plant, the land that is owned, are you saying that zoning would totally, would interfere with that to a big degree?
Well, zoning just allows you, I can go a step further, and special use permits, conditional use, those kind of things come under zoning that we can't currently do. And that allows you to put, especially a conditional use permit, the board can put conditions on a use that they see fit, you know, within legal means, that would help guide in a community a little more control and be very specific to that site. Whereas the site, you know, way out up a main highway or something, you wouldn't care as much. But if there's a site close to a neighborhood, you want to protect that a little more with some conditions, maybe of operation hours or more buffering or something like that. So you get more powers with that zoning to do more specific to each site.
Okay. If nobody has any more questions, then this was for discussion and information today, and so we will have some more at the next meeting. Thank you very much, Tanya, for coming out. Is Captain Sykes here? Here he is. We did some more, you know, obviously we adopted a new noise ordinance. There have been discussion in the Sheriff's Department about how to enforce the noise ordinance, and so Captain Sykes is here to update us on the results of the product of that discussion.
Good morning. So last Monday we had a meeting with Rick Champion with the DA's office, Madam Chair Gailey, County Manager Haygood, and the administration at the Sheriff's Office to talk about how we're going to implement an SOP for enforcement of the noise ordinance.
And SOP stands for?
Standard Operating Procedure. Basic guidelines for our deputies to go by so they understand what's expected, what they should be doing in the field. And my purpose here is I'm going to briefly cover those with you. I think you have those in your packet. On page one under operations, any enforcement action would have to be approved by a supervisor with the rank of a sergeant or above. Any enforcement action, including a warning, would have to be documented on our standard incident reports. We've listed in the SOP the exceptions to the ordinance. And on page two, section E, so upon determining the violation has occurred, we would create an incident report, issue a written warning. We would notify Central Communications, put a CAD note in that this address with this person. The reason we're doing the address and the name is because people move. And so what if we want to give a second, an actual civil citation to someone who was not there the first time. So those notes will be taken in on our CAD system. The second incident would result in the first civil citation in the form of a $50 fine. The second would result in the $100 civil penalty, and in addition would be the uniform citation on a criminal matter for violation of North Carolina General Statute 14-4. And thus through the fourth and any subsequent violation. The fourth incident will be a $250 fine and a criminal violation, and any subsequent violation within the same 30-day period after that would be, I believe, $500. As far as administration, our warrant clerk would be in charge of receiving the monies at the sheriff's office. And upon payment, those monies would be transferred weekly to the finance department with a copy of the violation. That way finance would know where these monies were coming from, because I believe we have to transfer those to ABSS. So we'd be able to, finance would know where these monies are coming from, so they'd know where they need to put them. The major administration will oversee all of these SOPs and would notify the county attorney if a violator has failed to pay the fine, so that a delinquency charge may be applied. We've also included a copy of our noise ordinance warning and civil citation for your, you guys to look at. Be happy to answer any questions.
Anybody taking a look at what budgeting, what we might anticipate based on the historical reports of noise issues?
Well, we had a discussion about that during the meeting. And coming from having been on patrol just a short time ago, we didn't have a lot of guidance. So there wasn't a lot of violations issued, because it was kind of ambiguous on our end what we should be doing. So that's the purpose of this. In 3 years, I remember I personally on one platoon issued one warning. I never got to the civil citation, but with setting this out where everybody knows where they stand and what they should be doing, we may see an increase in that. And usually that's in the summer months is when most of these, we have these sort of problems.
Right.
Nothing else, so thank you.
Thank you.
Great, thank you very much. All right, so we have a land development plan update.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Welcome. Fortunately, you're not here for me again. I brought our consultants in this morning. If you all are looking for updates on this land development plan as we move along, we're kind of in the beginning heats of it, per se. Our steering committee has been established, but we haven't had a meeting with them because we're working on the background information to begin to put together the thoughts of how this is going to go together, mainly demographics and kind of the nature of the county. We took our consultants out on a field trip. We took a day trip around the county, showing them kind of the highlights, the lowlights, the what is Alamance County field trip, and that went really well. We have pulled together what we call stakeholder meeting, which is next Thursday. It's over at our building. Over the day, in hour-long increments, we have groups like municipalities, and we have utility companies, and we have the school system, we have farmers are recommended to come in, we have realty groups. We have as many diverse groups as we could think of to bring in to try to get the broadest range of ideas and where we are and where we need to be as a county, so that we can get the input from as many different sectors of the county as possible. So that's an all-day event next week. Our consultants are handling that. They've actually asked for me not to be in there just in case anybody wants to say something they don't want me to hear. So don't ask me what goes on, because I won't know. I'll just get the report from them. But this morning, what we'd like to do is put a short presentation together of what this plan actually should be and where to look from here. So at this point, I'm going to give it over and let's do it.
Morning. Good morning. How y'all doing?
Good.
So my name is Jake Petrosky. I work with Stewart. We're the lead consultant firm for the land development plan. We'll be working in lockstep with staff, with you all, the planning board, and the steering committee and that sort of thing. So it's the consultant team is really us, Stewart, and we're kind of a multidisciplinary firm. We have landscape architects, engineers, and we have three offices, one in Durham, one in Raleigh, one in Charlotte. We've done a lot of planning and plans like this throughout North Carolina. And I've worked in other states as well, but primarily North Carolina. Some of the recent experience that we have that we're going to be thinking about is Greenville County Comprehensive Plan, a couple counties over. We worked a lot with Harnett County. Smithfield and Harrisburg. We recently did some there, and there's pieces of this that we've done elsewhere. But every county's different. Every county's unique, and that's part of what we're trying to understand is just what are you all doing here? What can we learn from other communities? And we're doing a lot of kind of outreach and input along the way. Also on our team is Economic Leadership. They're an economic development firm led by Ted Abernathy and Greg Payne, and they will be working alongside us. Economic development is going to be a theme and one thing that we need to delve deeper into. You had really good things going on in the county. Heard the workforce development presentation earlier, but there's always room for improvement. There's always more that we can do. I actually worked with Greg Payne and Ted on the Chatham County Comprehensive Plan a couple years ago, and we'll be drawing a little bit from them as well. In terms of some of the, especially the southern part of the county, has a lot of parallels with Chatham County. And they do work all across the state and all across the country. So really excited about having them on our team. One of the interesting things that we're going to be doing as part of this process is a State of the County Summit. So you all and a lot of other folks will be invited to a day sometime in January where we just get together, we hear from Ted will probably present some economic trends. We're also going to invite the chamber and some other folks to talk about some accomplishments, and we'll be kind of giving you a presentation on some of your trends as well, what's happening in the county. Your strategic plan a couple years ago was really interesting. It kind of laid out a blueprint for some of your strategic initiatives. It also outlined indicators and performance measures we're supposed to track and see how the county is making progress on these goals. So that is some of the things that we'll be presenting to you all and other folks throughout this process to say, okay, we had the strategic plan, it set direction. This is how well we're achieving that plan. Also on our team is Jackie Turner Consulting. Jackie, I've worked with her a number of years, and she specializes in public involvement and engagement. And as part of this process, we're going to be doing a lot of outreach and engagement with stakeholders, businesses, also residents, landowners, general public. This is really meant to be a community conversation that happens periodically in the county. Talks about the good things that we're doing and how can we do things better. So that's going to be her responsibility, is getting the word out. And more details will unfold. There'll be a survey. There'll be a number of public meetings. We're going to do public meetings in the north and south, southern part of the county, so to make sure that we can give people opportunities to attend meetings and not have to drive too far. But we're also open to ideas, and we want to make sure that we extend invitations and get as many people involved as possible. So if there's people that you feel need to be involved in this process, then certainly let us know, let Tanya know. The purpose of the plan is really fundamentally to promote health, safety, and welfare, protect property values, manage growth and change in the community, and guide growth and development as well, and focusing on improving quality of life for residents and businesses. Some of the things that are part of this plan is really delving a little bit deeper into some of the things that the strategic plan touched on, primarily land use and development, and the fundamental kind of underpinnings of land use planning and planning in general is a need to kind of provide a guide for growth and development. Generally, cities plan for their cities and ETJs, but then there's an unincorporated area that we're responsible for. There's a various enabling legislation that kind of sets the groundwork for implementation planning regulations. And there's been some recent legislation that we have to kind of to follow in order to keep the county in line with that legislation. If you have ordinances, then you have to have a comprehensive plan that ties to that. The last comprehensive plan in the county is 07, so you can see we're 12 years out from that. So it's time to make sure that our ordinances are guided by a larger document. That's the right thing to do, but there's also some legislation that really requires us to do so. So the difference between this land development plan or the comprehensive plan and ordinances, so this land development plan is meant to build on that strategic plan and provide general land use guidance and policy about development pattern. That could be uses, intensity, density. It should also provide guidance for infrastructure and service investment decisions. So it's not just about what happens in terms of land use. It's also about what does the county invest in, what happens on the edges of the towns in the county, and how do we work with them? How do we work with Department of Transportation and the MPO and make sure that land use decisions really happen in concert with other decisions on service provision and infrastructure and economic development and that sort of thing. It is policy, it's not regulatory, but it could lead to regulatory changes. So ordinance is really where your policy, the county's policy, hits the ground. So you have specifics in there, and this is the subdivision ordinance, watershed protection ordinance, heavy industrial ordinance we just talked about, farmland preservation, etc. And how these ordinances work together, or how could they work together better, is something that is really going to be important. You all are doing some updates to the HIDO now, but how could further adjustments be done? How could it work better with your watershed protection ordinance? These are all questions that hopefully we can arrive at some guidance on down the line. So the land development plan or the comprehensive plan is really the traditional tool for community planning. It's meant to be collaborative. It's meant to be this community conversation. It's typically a 10 to 15 or 20 year planning horizon. It's meant to be updated every 5 or 7 years. So we're not going to go to 2040 with this plan, but we need to be thinking that far out to understand the implications of our decisions today. And we're going to be looking at those trends. We're going to be looking at what happens if we do nothing. Is there any positive effects, potentially negative effects, and then we can pivot off that and make some decisions. And it's going to be examining kind of multiple things, the interconnectedness of different ordinances, different policies. The strategic plan talked a lot about agriculture. It talked a lot about economic development. It talked about public services. And those are some of those same themes that we're going to be talking about and how they're all interconnected. And again, they're not regulations, but they can inform regulatory changes down the line. So we'll be talking about a number of different kind of things as part of this plan: land use and housing, agriculture, environment, economic development, infrastructure, parks and open space. And that can really, it's not set in stone either. We can customize the detail we go into and the importance and our priorities based on what we hear from you all, from the steering committee, and from members of the public. But the end product, if you want to look at an end product and what we're shooting for, the Chatham County Comprehensive Plan is a good way to see that. I was project manager for it at another firm, and then Greg also worked on it from economic leadership. It really was kind of tailored to that county. Just like Chatham County, there's different parts of Alamance County that are very different from one another. So we need to acknowledge those differences, but we need to kind of move the ball forward and set some more detailed kind of policy direction in some of the areas. And even though that plan really had a little bit of detail in terms of land use recommendations, it also in some areas it didn't provide a lot of detail, and we can kind of use that customized approach as well. So the schedule, we're looking at this fall, we're into the initiation phase, and we've started the tour, we've started the analysis phase as well, but really we're looking at moving into the public engagement phase in December and January, and that's when you'll see a lot of events and a lot of opportunity for input. We'll need your help getting the word out about those things. The plan development will be this spring. But you should have, we should have a draft together sometime in early summer. And there'll be another round of public engagement then to kind of talk about what we're recommending and get some additional feedback. So that's kind of the rough schedule, but you know, around July it would be into the adoption process directly. Immediately we're working on putting together stakeholder interviews, and Tanya mentioned this, but we're going to be meeting with different folks from neighborhood groups, from infrastructure side of things, economic development side of things, business and realtors and agriculture, and talking about issues that they see as being a priority in the county and needing some additional attention. If you all have any suggestions for that, who we need to talk to, either as part of that process or another part of the process, either through, you know, a phone call or a quick meeting or an invitation to a public meeting, we're open to that. This is meant to just provide kind of an introduction, a point of departure. I really do want to give you all a chance to talk as well and tell us a little bit about kind of what your priority issues are that you think this plan could address and should address. And or, you know, what do you see happening in Alamance County over the next, you know, 5 or 10 years that we need to be proactive in thinking about? So, you know, those are kind of some general questions, but that's really all the presentation I have. We'll have much more detail to come, but I do want to kind of hear from you all.
Let me ask real quick, the small area plan, where does that fit in with your schedule? Is that part of that process?
Yeah, so it's kind of like a plan within a plan, so to speak. So, you know, Chad Seary is here as well from Stewart. And he is going to kind of be leading that effort. But you know, the part of the analysis that we're doing for the county as a whole is going to inform that. But there's also going to be some additional analysis customized to the snow camp area specifically. And if you think about it in terms of detail, this might be this general plan, land use plan, is going to make recommendations for different areas of the county. In snow camp, we might get into a little bit more detail. And we're going to have additional outreach there. So there will be some additional time spent in really thinking about that area and some recommendations that follow. This could be a template for additional small area plans elsewhere in the county that have a particular set of issues that need more attention. And you can think about Altamaha, you can think about Saxpaha, you can think about maybe there's an edge of Mebane or something that could fit the bill as needing some additional work and customizing some recommendations.
When you introduced him, you said something that I've always been interested in. You mentioned y'all rode around.
Yes.
Okay. What's your opinion of the northern access, north of the interstate, clear across our county, of availability of transportation as far as loops, thoroughfares, or whatever? I mean, is that something that will be looked at?
Well, the transportation piece will definitely be looked at as part of this. And I mean, it did take us a little while to get from east to west. I mean, it's a long county, it's a wide county, and there's no good way, and you have a river running through it. So, you know, if you're in the middle, you can get across pretty quick as long as there's not, you know, some accident. But on those edges, it is a little bit more difficult. But we'll be looking at, this will give us a chance to do, look at the county jurisdiction specifically. Whereas the MPO is a great intermediary between the towns and the county and the Department of Transportation. They're really focused more on the urban areas because that's where the congestion is today. That's where they have limited kind of time and attention to pay to their member governments, of which Alamance County is one of them. But this will give, we have a few engineers that work on staff, Todd Delk and him and a couple other folks will be looking at transportation issues that are uniquely the county's issues. And you know, it's not gonna, it might not be the traditional funding stream of highway money, but there might be some intersections, there might be some collector streets, there might be some smaller projects that really need to be at the top of the county's priority list, regardless if they're not yet at the top of the MPO's and DOT's priority list. So this hopefully will function and give us some idea of what those types of things are, so that you can have a set of priorities to give to the MPO and make sure that they're thinking about your needs.
See, at one time there was an inner loop plan, mm-hmm. and Graham City Council voted down their part. I think that vote was 3-2, if I'm not mistaken.
Southern loop, they got it.
Yeah, because they built part of it over in Burlington. They voted it down. But try to explain to somebody when you're south of the interstate how to cut through our community to go to Virginia.
It is a nightmare.
We have no, you know, who's our representative on that?
I'm on board.
You're on there? Are they looking at anything of that way?
No, they wrote it off.
Yeah, why? I mean, it's stunning to me. I mean, even Rockingham County, they've had loops for years.
You can get through Rockingham County really fast.
Yeah, well, see, the state helped them with that, trying to help them develop.
Yeah.
Because I used to live up in Eden.
And that is part of the problem. That loop had been on there for 20-some years.
Mm-hmm.
No funding to do the loop. So Graham says, okay, we have real estate here that nobody can deal with because this loop is on the map. Mm-hmm. So that's why they pushed to get it off of the map. Mm-hmm. But yes, you're right. It is a problem.
I told someone one time, I like you too much to try to tell you how to do it. Figure it out.
If we make a land use plan for the non-regulated parts of the county, obviously, and then Burlington or Graham or Bevan decide to come along and add to their ETJ, what impact does that have on our plan? Do they override our plan? Do they have to be consistent with our plan? What is it?
Well, the goal is to have development in the county be consistent with this plan. And I think on those edges, if they ask to be voluntarily annexed, then that is an option. The good news is the way that the ETJs exist currently are pretty adequate for growth and development. In terms of in and around the cities and towns, there's logical kind of delineated boundaries, south of the river and north of Alamance Creek, to where it kind of makes sense for them to stay more or less where they are. I mean, you got some anomalies. There's Swepsonville doesn't have an ETJ, and there's some things that I think we can provide some direction on. And it might be saying, hey, Swepsonville, if you're going to annex, this is the area where we think this is a great idea. And we would not necessarily be opposed to that, because that is services that the county is not providing. It's on an entity that arguably that's where it should be. I think that's my take on it now, is the ETJs are adequate for urban growth of the major municipalities, and it kind of makes sense for them to keep them. But there might be some anomalies, or there could be an economic development opportunity, or there could be some of the smaller towns that don't have an ETJ that we need to talk about, and we need to figure out what our stance is and what our recommendation is. It could be there's an economic development opportunity that's in the county jurisdiction, and what's the long-term plan to provide that with utilities? Because currently, that's the towns are the vehicle to provide utilities.
Right.
And we don't necessarily want to get into the utility business, because that's not really what our priority should be.
Well, it's just last week, I think, Burlington City Council voted to let somebody tie into the Burlington sewer system, South 87, which typically would have been in the Graham ETJ. Mm-hmm. But then they were thinking, I just read the story of it, I didn't follow it close enough, but they decided then that they didn't want to annex them at the time. So, I mean, it looks like spot zoning if you start looking at a map of different things that have happened in our county.
Mm-hmm.
And we need to be on board with municipalities. It's how we want our part that's outside of their border to look. And I think that was just a case of, it was clearly in the county, but Burlington City's making a decision to let them tie on to their outfall line sewage, which then they have 5-acre developable tract for, Thomas probably called it a convenience store or something.
Right, it's not 5 acres.
It was a restaurant,
convenience store with a grill.
One in the restaurant, yeah, with a group.
There's already a sewer line that goes down 87 to serve Southern High School, and it goes past his property. So they're just asking to tap on
the sewer. Water does. Sewer goes left to right. I'm sorry. I know a lot about that.
Well, it goes in the direction of gravity. But in either case, it serves property down 87. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And it is accessible from this site.
Yeah. You said adequate. How far out are you? What's the definition of adequate from a lifespan or looking forward?
In what regards?
Adequate? Well, I mean, our projections are 204,000 people by 2035, so that's going to grow a lot. So, mm-hmm. How far out are the extraterritorial jurisdictions?
30 miles outside.
That's one of the things that we'll be looking at in greater detail as part of this process. We're actually going to do a bit of modeling to look at available land in unincorporated areas and in ETJs so that we can answer that question. Based on population growth, a general accepted trend, is there enough room for rooftops and room for non-residential growth in ETJs or the county? That's what we're going to be getting at in the January. We're going to be presenting some of that to you all and the public and kind of asked to weigh in on direction. And we're going to do some scenario planning. So looking at, okay, is there enough room just in the ETJs for this type of growth? Or do we need to, be planning for some of that in the county? And what does it look like? And how could it be accommodated from an infrastructure standpoint, from an appropriateness standpoint, not ruin the character of some of the more rural areas of the county? That's going to be a big question that we need to tackle.
I was in a meeting recently talking with some mayors. We were talking about the number of units already approved on their various communities. It was over five, something in the neighborhood, possibly over 5,000 right now.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, but we'll have some numbers for you that will allow me to answer that question a little bit more fully, probably 2 months.
I'll say that I'm really excited that you're here, and I'm very glad that the county is moving forward with this process. I really support the small area plan development for Snow Camp for several reasons. One, because the super site across the line in Randolph County, and then there's two super sites in Chatham County, I believe. And I think that it's not unreasonable to think that, especially the Randolph County super site, when it's developed, it's going to create a lot of pressure for other businesses to be located to serve the whatever corporation chooses that as being their location. So people in Snow Camp, are just kind of almost sitting ducks waiting for something to happen to them. And I think that the Alamance Aggregates Quarry is a good example of that. We've been told multiple times that only through using planning methods can we really avoid another Alamance Aggregates. And I certainly don't want to see that happening to the people who live in Pleasant Grove or the people who live up 87 North. Mm-hmm. And so forth. And when you get a quarry coming in, you have questions and concerns with water quality and availability and air quality, mm-hmm. coming from that. And it's a quarry this time, but it could be an asphalt plant coming in to a rural community because of its proximity to Durham or to Greensboro. So you asked what other priorities are there? Those are the reasons that I personally thought that the small area plan for Snow Camp was a good place to start. I also am personally concerned about the new Highway 119 around Mebane and how that is going to open up development and change in the Pleasant Grove community and the northeastern sort of quadrant of Alamance County. And how that can affect people. If you could have an asphalt plant up by Mill Creek subdivision, mm-hmm. and then they could hop on 119 and be very quickly on the interstate and out to Durham. I mean, I don't know much about, pretty much nothing about the asphalt process, but it just seems that having that really beautiful, well-needed, lovely road, while it's beautiful and well-needed, it also brings its own challenges and opportunities. So that would be my answer to your question, is what other kind of priorities maybe are there to think about.
Thank you for that.
You may have. Okay, thank you so much for coming. Gentlemen, we've been going for about 2 hours now. Does anybody need a break? All right, let's have a recess. Ladies and gentlemen, if we could come back to order, please, and resume our meeting. The next item on our agenda is our Article 46 sales tax revenue option discussion with Mr. Haygood.
Well, good morning, Commissioners. I'm here this morning to gauge the board's interest in the possibility of putting the Article 46 sales tax option back on the ballot for the voters. I have just a couple of quick slides to go through with you and talk to you a little bit about that possibility. Do you have the slide, Jim?
Yeah.
Let's do that. So, the board remembers, we went through a lot of discussion about Article 46 sales tax option back when we were putting the bond projects on the ballot in, I believe it was November of 2018. So Article 46 is an option the county has to do a 0.25% sales tax on sales through most goods throughout Alamance County. And the commissioners have the ability to use the revenue from this Article 46 for any public purpose. So there's no restrictions on what you can do with the revenue created by Article 46. But it does require voter approval, and that voter approval must come from a countywide ballot. So it has to be put on a ballot in a countywide election. And the ballot language is determined by the state. There was recently some attempts to allow the commissioners to have more flexibility about the language on the ballot, but that did not work out in Raleigh. But one new law that has happened since we last talked about Article 46 is the county must wait 1 year between each attempt. So if the commissioners decided they were interested in putting this option on the ballot for the voters to consider in March in the primary, and it failed, you would then have to wait at least another year. You couldn't do it again in November. You can only do it one time per year. That's a new development. The Board of Commissioners may designate the use of Article 46 funds. Y'all remember when we did this in conjunction with the bond projects, the commissioners said that the proceeds would be used for educational purposes. You can do that. Last time the board did that by resolution, but we were not able to put that on the ballot. So the voters had to just know that the commissioners had passed a resolution to use the funds that way.
And we still could not put that on the ballot.
That's correct. Yes, the measure was introduced to allow the commissioners to do that if they took this kind of formal action, but it was not. It was not
approved.
What's that?
It was approved. Not approved.
That's right. Yes, sir. So the last estimate we had for Article 46 revenue for Alamance County, if the voters were to approve it and the commissioners were to institute it, was approximately $4.8 million. We were looking at the website Mr. Sutton shared. I think they estimated around $6 million. That was, I think our financial advisors used a different article from a different year than the Association of County Commissioners. But you could say between $5 to $6 million is probably a reasonable estimate for how much money an Article 46 option would create for the county.
Which would have what kind of impact on property taxes?
Well, yeah, what's the tax implication?
So I think what we had figured on our last estimate was 3.62 cents. So what we had said during the bond project was if the voters passed the sales tax option, then it would be that revenue would be equivalent to 3.62 cents. So it's probably somewhere in that range, close to 4 cents when compared to property tax.
Do we have any way of getting any sort of identification on what the breakdown is on where that sales tax revenue comes from, whether 20, 30, 40, 50%, whatever comes from outside of Alamance County, and which percentage comes from inside of Alamance County?
We've had those discussions before. That was a big topic of discussion back last time we talked about this option. And we've talked with the chamber, we've talked a little bit with the finance folks. The state doesn't identify that at point of sale, where the buyer is from. Are they from another county or another state? We know that we've seen our sales tax in Alamance County stay very healthy, and we've been fortunate to have institutions like Tanger Outlets and Alamance Crossing pop up, and we know lots of folks from outside the county shop there, but it's not possible for us to identify that. I think Chamber may be able to give some ideas of how many people pass up and down 8540 a day, which would give you some insight to how many people just come through here. And if some percentage of them are stopping to buy anything, whether that's gasoline or whatever they may buy, or shop at Tanger or Alamance Crossing, we would be taking advantage of those folks. But I couldn't put a quantifiable dollar amount.
You used to ask zip code where you live when you would pay.
Yeah. Now you can ride through Alamance Crossing and look at the car tags.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
I mean, I've done that. And when you get around Elon over there, there are a lot of Elon students, which Elon, by the way, pays no tax basically on anything institutional there. So.
That's great.
There are a lot of folks shopping over there that don't have North Carolina tags.
That's right. Well, it's certainly a way of taking advantage of the fact that we're, as we say all the time, we're very well situated in the state of North Carolina. Lots of folks pass through here. A lot of folks come here for Elon, for example. It's a way to take advantage of folks that are coming here to shop and the possibility of revenue they would leave behind.
Well, I might be getting ahead of where you are, mm-hmm. or where you're going, but if we put this on at the primary next year, would that give us lead time enough to adjust what we need for our budget next year and possibly see a reduction in the property tax?
So the only thing I would say, we're looking at about 90 days, I think, usually, before we start actually seeing those funds. It would be difficult for us to estimate exactly what dollar amount impact that would have. If you put this on the ballot in March and it passed, we'd be talking fiscal year 2021. I'll tell you, I'd be a little reluctant to give you a hard and fast dollar amount of revenue it would produce. It'd be nice to go through at least 1 year and see how much funding it would produce.
You already project a sales tax.
That's right.
Based on something you don't know too. So
that's right. Yes, that's correct.
That is a potential of
yeah.
Right.
Yes. So I think if you did it in March, if you put it on the ballot in March and it was able to pass, we would do the best we could to try to factor it into the fiscal year budget for 2021.
You could be conservative in your estimate, and then whatever is above the estimate goes into the fund balance, which has not been looking so good lately.
Yeah.
Not too healthy.
Yeah. And so we've talked about some possible uses of revenue from the sales tax option, because I understand, you know, the voters have to vote on this, and they have to find whatever is going to be done with the revenue to be acceptable, right? Or you just don't, it doesn't pass, and you don't get the revenue. So particularly in our technical review committee meetings with the school system and community college, we've talked about what could possibly be done with the revenue from the sales tax option. One thing that I would suggest the commissioners could consider is, as you know, we've talked about with the bond projects, we're going to be having a number of new facilities come online, right? We're at new buildings come online, either for the school system, particularly the new high school, as well as the community college are going to have new buildings that the county will be responsible for paying those light bills, heat bills, operating costs. In fact, our capital plan estimates about $2.3 million worth of new operating costs will be coming online for county government. That could be one use of some portion of the sales tax proceeds. Another would be the possibility of increasing capital funding, and that's particularly to the school system and the community college. We've had discussions with the superintendent, and in the past, he's had, I've worked at school systems where they establish a certain replacement value of buildings, and they try to make their annual PAYGO dollar amounts match that so they can stay on top of their capital needs. And the school system and the community college also have capital projects that are not in the bond projects or in their annual PAYGO list too. So that could be another consideration for what to do with sales tax dollars. Or you could specifically allocate a portion of funds from the new sales tax option to be directed specifically towards school security. Right, so the bond projects and the capital, the annual capital PAYGO for the schools have some school security measures in that plan, but there are other things that they would be able to do, and you would be able to tell the schools, we want you to use this money specifically for school security type projects. And of course, you could also use it to reduce the property tax rate. We went up
7.04 cents specifically for the bond projects. At the time, the hope was the sales tax would pass and you could have took 3.62 at least off of that. So the commissioners have a whole host of opportunities, what they could do with the sales tax revenue, any combination of these, all the funding toward any one of these, or some other option that the board may want to talk about. I think the key thing for me is to find out, one, are the commissioners interested in revisiting the sales tax option, Article 46? And if so, do you have any ideas of what you think you'd like to see it used for? And are you interested in it possibly being on the March ballot? Because if the board has an interest in the question being put before the voters in March, the Board of Elections has indicated they really need that information by the 1st of November. So we would come back at the next commissioners meeting with, I think, at least two resolutions. One that would say what you would want to do with the money. You don't have to do that. The other would be saying you want to put it on the ballot. So, lots to think about, but we're kind of getting to a point where if you want to do it in March, we need to go ahead and prepare some resolutions. So I'd be happy to try to answer any questions.
Let me, the point you're talking about, the bonds that we voted, that the citizens of Alamance County voted for, I understand that ACC is now trying to, the people voted on a parking deck. Now they want to change that to no parking deck. Can they legally do that? Don't we have to give them permission to spend that money?
Yes, they can, but it would take approval from the commissioners, because we laid out for the public a list of bond projects for the community college.
That's exactly right.
And so,
and now they want to change the rules of the game. That ain't gonna happen with my vote.
And I think we're planning for Dr. Gatewood to come next meeting to talk to you about why they think that's important, or why that's a possibility. So that'll give the board a good chance to ask questions of the community college about why they're thinking that way.
Well, this board is a wimpy board, in my opinion. They don't stand for nothing except to appease. And I think it's time that this board stood up to Mr. Gatewood and do what the people in this county voted for. Is I was against the bonds. I voted against the bonds, but the people voted for that parking deck, and by God, they deserve a parking deck. That's my opinion.
Thank you.
What do you think of sales tax?
I think that's a good idea. I think you've got the amount of people that have to pay higher taxes, this would cut the people's taxes.
If there was a guarantee to cut it, that's the key.
And I think we can give them a guarantee.
Well, you got to vote on it. Now, I want to ask you a question about the push for March. You said March about five or six times here. When you have a general election coming up not long after that, it's clear to me, in my opinion, I've been up here a good while, and I've seen the trends. I found that website. Shows who all had passed it, who all had not passed it, when the election was held, when it wasn't. And as clear as that blue sign on the front of your podium there, that people put it on in March so they could circumvent the majority of the voters that are going to show up in the general. With a hope. I don't think there's a question about it. It's a game plan. And they think, well, less people come out, more private interest people will come out, and we can get sales tax through them. Versus the general election, all the deplorables are going to show up, so they'll vote against the sales tax. But now, I would never support a vote for it to be not in a general election, where the full electorate can be counted on to come out more than in the primary. It's a ploy. It's clearly a ploy. And in my opinion, this board nor government shouldn't be involved in ploys to try to get more tax dollars for whatever purpose, whether it be weak or strong or deserved or not. But I would never support it in an off-year, in a non-general election. It's too big an issue for it to be a primary.
Yeah, I agree with you, too.
Well, I'll respond to that. I don't see it, from my perspective, as being a ploy. I would support putting it on the March ballot. But for the budgetary reasons, if we delay it from March to November, then we lose out on quite a few months of revenue that could be used to defer people's property taxes.
Did you think it's going to defer them?
Well, that would be my commitment to the people. Is
and
at
we
least
would
part
have an
of,
option to vote on that. Yes.
At least part of a sales tax increase would go to property tax relief.
Well, I hear you, and I think I respect that opinion, but I say it's a ploy. And the trend has always been off year or try to get it in the primary because they know who shows up in the generals. They know it. And that's why, in my opinion, it is a ploy. It's the best attempt that you could throw a dart at getting it approved.
I appreciate your point of view, and I won't dispute that in some people's minds, maybe they are trying to game the system to get it the best chance of passing. From my personal perspective, I think it's most important to look at what's the best for the bottom line of the county and for property tax revenue.
I hear that. That's a nice comment. That's nice rhetoric. But I would say that we are not in dire straits to where we have to circumvent the voters of this county to get more tax dollars or to use ploys. We've gone 100 and how many years without it? And I don't think 6 more months would... 7-8 more months, whatever, would destroy the financial standing of this county. But
it would help the citizens of Alamance County should it pass. And you and I say we're going to be here to December of next year.
Right.
If it's passed in November, you and I won't have a say on what happens.
We'll be gone no matter what happens. But again, I say it's a ploy, and I'll stick to that, and I won't support a spring or a primary vote on it.
Having gotten my tax bill, I'm all for it. And the increases to my property taxes.
I hear you.
Yeah. I might have to come find where you was hanging out so I could stay with you after my wife looked at me.
It's about 200 miles away, so yeah. Okay. Or will be, anyway.
Commissioner Carter, do you have anything?
Well, I'm just listening to the comments, and y'all were saying them faster than I could get in. So, I agree with what you just said, Amy. I mean, the whole purpose, and from my perspective, was I wasn't even thinking of a ploy. But I've heard Mr. Sutton's comments before about wanting to stay away from a primary election versus a general election. My issue, once again, the same one. If we get it in there before, if we get it in there in time to have it hit the books during the budget year next year, then we have a chance of bringing down some of the property taxes we had to implement to support these bonds and the capital projects. So,
well, one time we had a discussion about a sales tax, the issue, and I asked the vote sitting right here. No offense, Mr. Petty, I love you, but the bottom line is I looked down at you and I said, are you willing to roll back property taxes commensurate with what you bring in on the sales tax? And would you amend your motion to that? You said no. And I said, well, that's just a tax increase then. And that's when Ms. Massey, God bless her, chairman, she looked down at me and she said, well, that's the whole idea. And in my opinion, that's a lot of what this is going to be like.
Well, Mr. Hager, you asked the question about if the sales tax were to pass, what kind of commitment would the board make to do with the money? And to answer that from my personal perspective, speaking for myself, not anybody else, I would say that I would like to see a part of it go to property tax relief and a part of it to go to pay for the expected operational increases that would be incurred as a result of the bonds, like the cost of getting the new high school going and the cost of the parking deck, which was estimated to be $300,000+, things like that, so that, because that's always been sort of at the back of my mind, is that we're looking at more money for operations once these projects come online. So I would like to see that. I would also support a piece of it going to enhance school safety. And I'd be willing, you know, open to listening to other commissioners' perspectives about.
Well, I think you hit it on the nail head with where the money could go. Number one being to reduce property taxes.
That's my what I'm in favor of.
And to be able to use it in next year's budget, we will be here to actually have a voice in. I'll probably get it in March.
Echo November.
Okay.
All right.
Well, it sounds like that wraps up that discussion. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
So, Mr. Vipperman, do you have a welcome billing agency change for EMS?
I think so.
Well, I know so.
About time.
So, thank you, Madam Chair, members of the board. So I've come before you today to request that the board approve a contract with EMS Management and Consultants to be our new EMS billing agency. EMS has utilized an outside vendor for billing services since about 2008, and since 2015, AMB has served as the role of our vendor. As the end of the contract with AMB approached, an RFP was sent out. We worked with purchasing and legal to send out an RFP during May and June to examine different agencies. EMS then partnered with finance and the county manager's office to review and interview several of those different agencies. And as a result of that process, we all believe that EMS MC will offer the highest level of service to EMS and most importantly to our patients. EMS MC has the advantage of being located in Winston-Salem, so they're very, very local and very ingrained in the changes that come from the state of North Carolina. One such change that we've been working with legal on right now is Medicaid transformation, and they're among the forefront of working with that, you know, where the Medicaid is going into more of a privatization mode, and you'll be dealing with five different insurers and having to contract with all of those, and then transportation brokers. So it's important to have a billing company that thoroughly understands those implications. So EMSMC has provided two representatives to answer any questions that you might have. Kim Stanley is the Chief Compliance Officer, and then Regina Crawford is their legislative liaison who spends most of her time in Raleigh advocating for EMS with the state. So I'll be happy to answer any questions that you may have, and I'm sure that Kim and Regina are as well.
We would be voting to approve contract, is that right?
Yes, ma'am.
I guess I still have a question on this a little bit. When a person has a problem with the billing, what contact do they have with the county?
We do have a billing liaison that in our office that is full time, that's dedicated to keeping track, you know, keeping tabs on the billing agency, and then helping patients as they have problems to get that local face.
Right, because that's of all the complaints I ever hear about the
right.
EMS service.
So it's kind of
who to contact, and I don't know, and they won't.
Yeah, she kind of acts as a navigator almost to help navigate between the North Carolina debt set off and the billing agency and all of those things.
Because it gets confusing to the consumer.
It does.
As they're using that service, and of course we would hope that you guys would be very responsive, but in a case that it doesn't work out right, where the customer feels like their questions are being answered properly, we need to make sure that we have a communication between the county and this group.
Well, does EMS use a call center, or do they use, in-house people that answer the phones when you have a customer complaint?
Yes, sir. So we have 30 customer service representatives. All are located in Winston-Salem, North Carolina. Those are our employees, and so they answer about 20,000 phone calls a month. So we operate that call center here locally in North Carolina. We have the ability to set that up and answer your dedicated line exactly how you want us to. So we could say billing agency on behalf of Alamance County. We could say Alamance County EMS billing. You all can set that up exactly how that's answered, and it is a dedicated line.
So do you have any insight into what the typical wait time is before
Sure.
you can actually talk to a live person?
Yeah, so our wait time right now is around 36 seconds, and we maintain that less 20, than
20,000 calls.
Yes, yes. We maintain less than 60 seconds answer time. But we've been well under that goal for going on a year or two now.
Additionally, your invoices that you're sending out can be labeled Alamance County. They don't have to be to our billing company. They can be personalized to reflect Alamance County.
Your logos would all be in full color on the invoice, so that was very clear. The other thing that we will offer is a strategic account manager, and his name is Seth Lawrence. He will be the main point of contact for Ray as well as for billing liaison, so they match up perfectly. They are a dedicated resource to you all, and so if there's any question, any concerns, he's available day or night to speak with. And as Ray said, navigate through our departments back to Ray's billing agent, billing liaison.
If we were to start to get reports that they were waiting, somebody waiting on the line 20 minutes before they got a live person, how would you handle that?
I would ask Ray to call me directly, and he has my cell phone, and we would take care of that. I would say that is due to a technical difficulty, maybe something wrong with the phone line or the internet at that point, because that usually does not happen. But yes, we would rectify that immediately.
Okay, we'll just be seeking a motion to approve the contract.
Motion to approve.
Second.
Okay, have a motion and a second to approve that contract. If there's no more discussion, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Anyone opposed? Thank you.
All right, thank you.
Thank you, Ray.
Is there somebody here from the health department? So we got approval to apply for a grant.
Yes. Good morning, commissioners. I'm Jana Elliott with the health department, and I'm here today seeking approval to apply for and, if awarded, budget up to $10,000 in grant funding from Impact Alamance. These funds would be used to fund key staff members to attend One Key Question Train the Trainer training. This training will be held in North Carolina and would allow the staff to provide One Key Question training to internal staff and to external agencies. Additionally, a monitor, charging station, and team packs would be purchased to continue the agency's team-friendly initiative. There's no required match for this grant, and it's an upfront grant where we receive the money upon award and then report out mid-year and annually.
I think the program looks like an interesting program. The question, I really like the way it's going to be designed, so I'll make a motion to approve that.
Second.
Okay, we have a motion and a second to approve that grant application. Is there any more discussion? If not, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Okay, next we have our second opportunity for public speakers on non-agenda related items. Signed up to speak was Eddie McKinnon.
Thank you, ma'am. It's an honor to be able to address you today, and what I have is not a request, it's not a problem, it's a praise. Someone once said there are three types of people in the world today: those who make things happen, those who watch things happen, and those who wonder what the heck just happened. Sunday, a week ago, yesterday, I had a break-in in my home, and I had the opportunity to see a little bit of all three. Our home of over 40 years was the victim of what any homeowner fears, a break-in. But that's just the beginning of the story. Our daughter, who lives beside of us, noticed things not normal. A strange car, strange visitors, and somehow our family pet, our little dog, 136-pound German Shepherd, moved from the inside of the house to the backyard. Neighbors from all sides and across the street noticed them too. 9/11 was notified, and we were privy to see the best law enforcement team in North Carolina jump into action. A quick-thinking woman, whom I love dearly, also became involved. That woman was my wife. Not only did she block the subject's vehicle in, but she had enough gumption about her to take a picture of one of the subjects as he ran away. Then we stood back and watched the men and women of the Alamance County Sheriff's Department work like a well-run machine. Canines were in action. A member of the department set up a drone that helped spot one of the accused, and the men and women of the Sheriff's Department were with all of the necessary items that an officer wears, including the heavy vests and 95-degree temperature, went through the woods like a good hunting dog chasing his prey. There were 7 vehicles from the Sheriff's Department there and Mr. Tommy Day with the State Highway Patrol, all of them racing through the woods. As well-trained and disciplined keepers of the law, they did what they do best. They apprehended both suspects, one after about 45 minutes and the other within the next hour. It was a true honor to see our law enforcement officer successfully complete that task. Many thanks for my family, and we would like to see our officers. We like it when we see our officers make good things happen. Their training, dedication, persistence, and a whole lot of sweat that day told me that Sheriff Johnson, his men, and women all the way down to dispatch are absolutely fantastic. I used to wonder sometimes if our county was really safe and its people firmly protected, but now there's no more wondering. I know for sure the answer to that story. My family is very thankful, and we are very certain of our protection. Monday morning, I went to the sheriff's office and expressed deep thanks to the department. I have in the past stopped and had prayer with officers as our paths cross, and I'll continue to do that. Thanks again for outstanding work, an outstanding group of men and women, and for the K-9 team. Even when this entire ordeal, I realize that we're honored to be safe and safely cared for. As I mentioned, I went to the office Monday morning and was fortunate to sit with Chief Parker and Captain.
You're 30 seconds.
I'm 2 minutes and I'm through. I'm sorry.
I'm sorry.
30 seconds and I'm through.
I'm sorry. I can't.
Thank you. Come back again.
I'm sorry.
I wish to thank the Sheriff's Department greatly. They did a fantastic job.
Thank you very much. We have to be sure that everybody is treated the same in the commissioner room, too.
I understand.
Everybody gets thank you very much. And I'm sure we'll have an opportunity to comment on that, too, in a minute. Before we do, Ken Hall.
Good morning. My name is Ken Hall. I'm a longtime resident of Alamance County. And I want to thank you for your past dedication to the recycling program. That gentleman is a hard act to follow, but I'm going to do the best I can. Anyway, this has to do with something we're all concerned about, trash. Everybody is concerned about it. The more public, the more people get in the county, the worse it gets. I happen to be an avid kayaker. I kayak the Hall River from down near Saxpaw all the way to Swartzenville and back twice. Believe me, that river is polluted with trash, mainly plastic, but there's other things. Now, the one thing that I think is a problem is these water bottles, because a lot of people now buy water. What do they do with the bottle? Bingo, trash. Anyway, I got some little things I'm going to take up with Mr. Walker concerning the landfill, and I'm not going to, because of time limitations, I'm not going to dwell on what the problems are as I see it with the landfill, but there are some problems. But I want to congratulate the commissioners for the recycling program that y'all have. I've been doing it now since actually before you started the free recycling, and I can tell you right now, it helps. What I would like to see as a citizen, a concerned citizen, and I have had, did road cleanup. I'm talking about adopt road thing before and been involved in that. And that's the last time I talked to the commissioners in Alamance County was concerning the road cleanup. But anyway, I do road cleanup, and I have done it with my own truck. I got a 2015 Dodge Ram. It's got 156,000 miles on it. So I'm out there quite a bit, and I see we got a trash problem in Alamance County. And I want to tell you, I think another thing that the commissioners are going to be dealing with is there's a problem with enforcing the rules concerning tying the trash on the trailers and what have you. There is definitely cargo nets and other things available, but what I see is a bag of trash will fall off, then the mower will come along, the contract mower, hit it, it'll go all over the place, and then you got a big mess. So go after the problem, commissioners, which is securing the load. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Hall. Okay. Do we have any commissioner responses?
Ms. Gailey, we believe there's some omissions earlier, and since I was signed up, is it possible to comment?
Yes, you can. Okay. I mean, it's not on, well, Dr. Ulickney, it's not on this paper.
Okay, well, I signed up earlier. I didn't know if we could comment now.
Oh, no, you would sign up to speak before
and
after
send
the beginning
then.
Of the meeting.
Like
and that would be on an agenda-related thing, so this
I
is
gotcha.
The public
okay.
comment period.
Just checking.
Been approached by...
Oh, wait, are you responding to the public comment?
Yes. Mm-hmm.
Okay, I'm sorry.
Been approached by DOT in some of the meetings I'm involved in concerning the use of detainees, county detainees, to pick up road trash. Talked with the sheriff about it, and he's on board with the idea.
You mean trustees from the jail?
Trustees from the jail being used to pick up trash.
We can't use the ICE detainees, but we can use
right. Okay.
Trustees. Let's be careful.
Right. But anyway, the DOT will pay us, pay the sheriff's office for them to do that, so it'll be a source of revenue, and give those trustees an opportunity to be outside, away from the jail. I think they would probably like that, but I think it's something we ought to take a look at.
I think it's a good idea.
I think there's been some work with the landfill and the sheriff's office about how to put that program together, and I think there was some equipment that needed to be acquired, which I think DOT was going to help us do. So
right.
That program's in the works, and hopefully we'll be seeing trustees out on the roads making Alamance County a cleaner place soon.
Great.
Well, we got a lot of excess revenue coming in from the marshals and ICE contracts as well, so we ought to be able to pay for some of that.
Okay, Mr. McKinnon, I wanted to say I'm so thankful that you and your wife are safe. You sound like a lucky man.
Thank you,
and I'm so happy that everything worked out well for you. 136-pound dog is a big one.
Yeah, he shook hands with the first gentleman who came in the house. His hand, the gentleman's hand and my dog's mouth met one another.
Good dog. That's a good dog. What's your dog's name?
Oso.
Oso. Oh, that's a good name.
Big German Shepherd.
Bear?
It means black bear in Spanish. When he was a puppy, he looked like a little black bear.
We have a German Shepherd, too. They do look like little bears. They're so cute. I love them. Good dogs. Well, I'm glad everybody is safe and that it all
worked
out.
Thank you, ma'am. I appreciate that.
Okay. Mr. Hager, do you have a report today?
I do have a couple of items for the commissioners to just consider. We included in your packet this meeting a copy of the quarterly finance and fiscal report. One of the highlights that I certainly am pleased to see is that these are unaudited results, but in our employee insurance fund, revenues exceeded costs by a little over $1.4 million. That's great news. As you know, we've been battling to get out of a over $2 million hole in our insurance fund, and that will take us to just a little over $600,000 in the hole. So we are making good progress. That's took a lot of work to do, and we've also had a very good year, we believe, again unaudited, in our workers' compensation fund. Our revenues exceeded costs by a little over $100,000. That's a great trend for us. Make that fund healthy too. So you can take a look at the rest of the quarterly financial report. And I also wanted to let the commissioners know that we're in the process of implementing our facility plan. If you remember several months ago, I came to the commissioners and showed you kind of an outline for the two campuses, downtown Graham and across town at the Human Service Center on Graham-Hubdale Road. We're really working to set the stage for the Graham campus development. We are preparing to move. The Sheriff's Office has CSI folks in the small brick building there. Used to be Board of Elections many years ago. We're going to move those folks over across the street into the annex building on the opposite corner from the county office building. And that will make way for demolishing that CSI building. It is not in the best of shape. It needs a total roof replacement, but it's actually
right in the way of where our future new court office building will go. So we're going to move the sheriff's CSI folks over to the annex. We'll also be relocating. We have a couple of HR employees that are in the annex that will be moving back over to this side of the street. They'll be going into the basement of the civil court. We are going to move Veteran Services. Veteran Services is inside the annex. They're staying in the annex. They're going across the hall, across the building to the planning and inspection side. And we'll be shuffling the planning and inspections departments around inside the annex building. And the last piece, just to update you on, we are researching space for the new Board of Elections equipment. The last item I'm going to talk to you about has to do with the Board of Elections. But the Board of Elections will soon be buying new equipment. Their current equipment are stored over at the Ralph Scott building over off of Turrentine Street. That is no longer our building. We actually need to relocate from there. So we're looking into new space for the Board of Elections. And we'll be bringing information to the commissioners about the Board of Elections equipment on October 21st. We plan to use, we have designated funds that the commissioners designated for this facility plan purposes that were from the sale of the Peak property and also the Turrentine Street property several years ago. I estimate this will be about $40,500 total to make all these moves. And again, it sets the stage for us eventually building new court building. And the long-term plan, build the court offices, get all the court folks and courtrooms out of civil, make this entire building county government, and open up J.B. Allen Criminal Court with all the courtroom spaces. But I will keep you posted, but there'll be county folks will be moving around in the near future. And the final item I have for you to consider is I've received a resolution that's been approved by the Alamance County Board of Elections. The Board of Elections spent a great part of last week debating about what type of voting equipment to purchase. You know, the state's changed the requirements. You have to have a paper ballot now. The Board of Elections has determined the type of equipment that they want to purchase. And they that equipment is going to cost $1,178,920. It will be a little more than that because that does not include voting booths, security bags, and some other items that Ms. Holland has indicated that they will need. But if you'll remember, in our capital plan, we had capacity to borrow up to $3 million to do this. So this is still less than the dollar amounts that we had thought this was going to cost us. But I have a copy of this resolution that Kathy brought last Friday that just needs to be presented to each commissioner. So this is from the Board of Elections. It is the resolution that their board passed that identifies the equipment that they'll be purchasing. So you'll hear more about this purchase at our next meeting, but it was important that you receive that today, and that came in too late to go on the agenda. So, and if there's any questions, I'll be happy to answer them, but that's all the new info that I have.
Okay. Can we have any questions?
I will be gone November 4th. That's the first day of a class experience. Yeah, I'll be me. That's my first day. I can't miss it. Too many people involved.
Well, I think we would have to have you, if you were not present for a vote, then it wouldn't be unanimous, right, Mr. Albright? He has to be present for there to be a unanimous vote. So we'll just plan for that to be a morning meeting so that you can attend. That's very important.
Morning.
Do I?
You will be available for morning?
Yeah, yeah. It's only in the summer that I can't be here in the morning. Yes, our classes start after school and go to about 7. And that's the first day, and I'll have 40-some kids in there, and it's hard to get somebody to come on the first day, let alone the fifth day or 13th day. You know, I don't want to belabor this issue of beat a dead horse, because I don't think the horse is dead. He's just rubbing his back up against the fence post. But right here is a comment. Orange County, they didn't do it. I mean, it was their analysis by somebody, an analysis of what they were doing. This guy's name was Dr. Michael Sonera, JLF Director of Research and Local Government Studies. And he was analyzing or giving commentary on why a referendum was shot down over there in Orange County, 2-1, for sales tax. And then they wanted to move it to an earlier election, like what we're looking at here. And his comment was, quote, "It seems commissioners are attempting to win approval this time by cynically manipulating the process." And granted, he's talking about that one, but I believe the overtones clearly would carry here, in my opinion. So that's,
And I would challenge any of you who are going to vote for Putnam in a primary to show me a conservative organization like Civitas or John Locke Foundation. And I don't do everything they say. As a matter of fact, I don't even read what they say other than I know that they're conservative and I know what the trends are and what their analyses are. I would challenge anybody to show me where they say that's not a poll when it's done that way versus a gem. So that's all I got to say about it. You guys thought that's fine, but it's kind of apropos of my
opinion. What is the deadline on that?
For
us to make a decision.
It would be best if that were done at the next meeting. I think the Board of Elections has said by the end of October, 1st of November. So that gives them plenty of time to prepare the ballot. They have to share that resolution with the state board in Raleigh and let everybody know this is going to be on the ballot locally. So if the commissioners were interested, and that's your option, you can put it on any countywide ballot. If you were interested in the spring, it would need to be at the next meeting.
So we could put it on there as a discussion topic again. Yes, right? I mean, the vote on it, you got to have it on your
agenda. Right, yeah, well, it needs to be either way. I'll just say I'm not cynically trying to manipulate anything. I'm trying to do what's right for the taxpayer of Alamance County. And we had an 8-cent tax increase in 1 year, followed by a tax increase the previous year. And we're looking at more tax increases possible because of bringing the high school and stuff like that online. I am personally super tired of property tax increases, speaking for the Gailey household. And I would like to see people get property tax relief, and I would like to see them get it sooner rather than later, if that's what they choose to do. If people don't want the sales tax increase, they can vote against it. But I think that John Locke Foundation or whoever can say whatever they want to, but at the end of the day, I answer to, as well as the rest of the board does, to the people who we represent, and is my sincere opinion that is the best interest, if we are going to have a sales tax increase, to get it going earlier rather than later, so that we can budget for it.
I still say that's a ploy, and I'll remind you that you voted for the tax increase. I didn't. And the tax increase prior you voted for.
Yes, you are absolutely right.
I did. So the bottom line is, I'm going to separate issues and look at motives, intentions, and red herrings in a debate. And I would say it's a red herring to drag across, you want to cut property tax when you've raised them, and I want to do this when I might not have supported it. It's a red herring to not say that it's, to give your explanation, in my opinion, as to why it's not a ploy. And I guarantee the most conservative organizations out there in the state of North Carolina would agree with me.
Well, in my opinion, I think I have explained why I do not see it as being a ploy, and I certainly would respect somebody else's alternative to disagree without calling it a red herring or any other kind of... And I will respond.
Good.
So,
how many red herrings do we need? I'm in a good mood. Never mind. Excuse me, Thomas.
Okay, do we have any other questions or comments?
Well, one of the things that I think we all might recall is that we voted to seek a health care benefit for our detention officers. It's been approved in the House, but it's still unapproved in the Senate. And I don't know what we can do to get our state senator to move that bill forward. But it's a local option bill, and we need to get that moved forward in the Senate. I'd like to see if there's something to help that, help us get that benefit in place for our detention officers.
Madam Chair, I'd like to respond to Bill's comment about the parking deck at ACC. Number one, it's not totally off the board as far as being an option there. It's still on the drawing board because the designers haven't designed what's going to be built. Their option they're looking at is not just maybe let's go build a 4-story parking deck. Let's see if there's room on the property to put spaces. Property decks cost $22,000 per space.
Yeah.
To go on land, around $5,000. So there, we've looked at that, and I think maybe Dr. Gatewood could get the designer to come and just show some ideas of what they're looking at doing.
Yeah.
Would clarify your mind, because what on that board of building and grounds there, we look to, you know, and work with them to kind of figure out what's the best use of the dollar.
Yeah.
So I think it would behoove the board to see what's out there.
Yeah, I agree. Okay, I'm okay with that.
Sure.
Are there any plans for the decks to be below the buildings?
Well, I think Dr. Gatewood will be bringing his design team and the folks from the architects with him on next meeting. And I'm not sure if they've looked at
We've had a meeting that was one of the possibilities. It was several things.
I'm sorry.
Go ahead.
They should have never put it on the ballot and told that's what they were voting for. A lot of people voted for that reason. You know, that's what people are sick and tired of government saying one thing and doing something else.
Well, the schools are second guessing now, the magnet schools.
Yeah.
And only months after saying how many people would go in, 1,000 per student, I mean, school, now they're not even sure.
Well, being on the board of trustees at ACC, I take it very serious that we want to spend the taxpayer dollars the best way we can. And when I voted for that, I don't know that I really put it in the back of my mind. I'm voting for a parking deck. I was voting for the betterment of Alamance Community College and the programs. And that's where they're going with that. So, it'd be good to see the board come up with and have the designer come and explain the options that are out there. Because if that's what people in the county really wanted, they need to let us know, because they want a big parking deck. We can give them a big parking deck and a 4,000 square foot science building, as opposed to a 12,000 square foot building and no parking deck, or move it out across the campus.
On that subject, the picture I saw in the paper, I can't remember, I think that was in y'all, I'm not sure, showed stacking cars in some sort of a system.
There is an option in the planning right now. There's a elevated area where you may come in on one level to one deck and come in from below on another deck, where you don't have all the ramps, which costs a lot of money and take up a lot of space. That's another option. So
I got lost in the garage at Duke because of that.
when you can't get, if you come in one way, you can't get out one another unless you go to the side.
Okay, we have a little business left to do with going into a closed session for some personnel stuff. So I move that we now go into closed session pursuant to North Carolina General Statute Section 143-318.11A6 to consider the performance of present employee.
Second.
So all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Session. All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Okay, so we considered, in closed session, we considered the performance of employees and no action was taken. So all the items on the agenda being completed will be adjourned.
Thank you for watching the Alamance County Commissioners meeting. Meetings of the Alamance County Board of Commissioners occur on the first and third Monday of every month in the Commissioners' Chambers at the County Office Building at 124 West Elm Street in Grand. Typically, the first meeting of the month occurs at 9 a.m. and the second meeting occurs at 7 p.m. Changes to the meeting schedule will be posted on the county website at www.alamance-nc.com. The video of this meeting is broadcast on LocalGov TV. Please go to www.localgovtvnc.com for more information about this schedule and to see more videos produced by your local governments. You can also access this meeting through our website at www.alamance-nc.com or at our YouTube channel. Technical questions regarding this meeting's broadcast or production may be sent to our county webmaster at webmaster@alamance-nc.com. This address is for technical questions only. Comments and questions about the content of the meeting may be made to the commissioners themselves. You can find their contact information at the Alamance County website at www.alamance-nc.com. There, you can click on the link that says County Commissioners to learn more about our commissioners, read minutes and agendas of commissioner meetings, and find other information about the county commissioners. You can also send mail correspondence to County Commissioners, 124 West Elm Street, Graham, North Carolina, 27253. Again, thank you for tuning in to the Alamance County Commissioners meeting. Thanks for tuning in. If you're watching on YouTube, be sure to hit the subscribe button to stay up to date on all our latest video content. If you're watching on LocalGov TV, be sure to visit their website to see all of the content made for you by your local governments.